In this episode, we have Carlos from Corvus Belli to take us through Infinity CodeOne. You definitely want to watch that one. Right, this week we're giving away a Mythos two-player bundle. Rules and Gubbins, Priory, and Hidden Ones. If you haven't seen Mythos, it is absolutely gorgeous. To be in with a chance of winning that, it's dead easy. All you have to do is click like. Please click like you've never clicked like before. Make sure you're subscribed to the channel on YouTube and post a comment below, either here on YouTube or increase your chances by coming across to ontabletop.com and posting a comment below the video there. We'll be picking one lucky winner at random, and you're going to walk off with some of the most beautiful minis in the industry. Right, it's Friday night. Let's get stuck in. Weekend starts now, gamers. Right, time to get stuck in. Before we do, just a very quick one. I just want to say a massive, massive thank you to everybody who is joining the Cult of Games at the moment. The Cult of Games is what keeps this all running. It's the best club in the world, man. It's something you absolutely want to be part of. So if you fancy helping us out and keeping this whole project alive, there's only one way to do it currently that we can think of. Come and join the Cult of Games, and you get to join a proper, proper cult. Right. Guys?
Yeah.
I have been looking forward to this.
We've even made it difficult.
Yes, it's not easy to join the Cult of Games. And if you can do it, if you actually manage to join the Cult of Games, you are something special.
So that's the initiation ceremony, basically, yeah.
If you find you have difficulty joining the Cult of Games, just send me an envelope with cash.
Right. Rasputin has spoken. It's time to get stuck in. All important, guys. Start of the show. It's time for Indie of the Week. Right. Who's the most important part of the show this week, guys?
So the company that we've chosen to go with this week is a little bit of my pick, a little bit inspired by what you said a couple of weeks ago, Warren, as well. Also, Jerry likes this company as well. So it's all good. Everyone loves these guys.
They're well liked.
Yeah. So this is Northumbrian Tin Soldier. Now, they came to my attention for something that we'll look at later in this sort of like dive into their web store. But the two famous ranges, I guess they're well known for, are both the Nightfolk and the Nightfolk Hunters. So here you can see their website. They do some absolutely amazing stuff. This may be a teaser as to what we are looking at in the future that I fell in love with. But yeah. They do this range called the Nightfolk, and it's a bunch of miniatures which are quirky, weird, draw on lots of, you know, archetypal fantasy styles and aesthetics, but also change things up and do things in different ways as well. So as you can see here, they've got some fantastic little, you've got the Murder of Crows there, which is very, very cool indeed. It's all got a very much of a, I guess you'd say like a Jim Henson style feel to a lot of what they do.
Yes,
a lot of it is drawn from that kind of idea, those kind of puppets and those old movies like Labyrinth and stuff like that in the past. And I think it looks perfect for those kind of alternative war bands that people might want to make on the tabletop.
I love
these goblins. They're so cool.
Oh, yeah.
The very Kev Adams meets Brian Froud.
Yes. Aren't they lovely? Oh, I love those. Yeah. Absolutely love those. Yeah. On the topic of crows and a murder of crows, I get to pitch the Cult of Games again here, because the Cult of Games this week helped me out, because we have world-renowned Twitchers as part of the Cult of Games. So I've had a bird, I assumed it was a bird, out here somewhere outside the Studio One, and he goes like this. Woo, woo, woo. Woo-hoo-hoo. It's kind of like a woo-hoo-hoo. But I knew it couldn't be an owl because I didn't see the long dangly legs. So I wondered what it was. So I reached out into the Cult of Games via the Discord channel, friendliest place on earth. Keeps all sane, and I'm completely sane. So I reached into the Discord and I said, Cult of Games Twitchers, I need your help. So I described, whoop, whoop, whoo, and they helped me identify it, that it was a dove. I have a dove. From above.
A dove from above, yeah.
So I've even seen him. I have some electricity pylons that are going across and delivering coronavirus directly into my backyard, apparently.
See if you have any light for it.
But the dove from above was perched up there, making this most beautiful woo-hoo-hoo noise.
You know that on average, I think we have something like 800 million viruses drop on us every day from the sky.
From space. And there's another interesting...
just from the regular sky. Yes, I know there can be panspermia on us.
No, I wiped that off. But what can happen is, you know the way the sun gives off wind, right? If the sun gives off a lot of wind... it compresses the atmosphere and pushes the viruses down. So you will notice that there's a correlation between solar maximums every 11 years and pandemics.
There you go.
There's a cool conspiracy theory, because if you blame the sun, you know, you're not going to get into trouble for blaming the sun, are you?
Only one thing to do, nuke it.
Well, there you
it's
go.
The only way to be sure, man. It's the only way to be sure.
If you're watching this video, you're lucky, because we've said cultists, we've said conspiracy theories, we've said viruses, we've said nukes.
Oh, yeah.
This ain't getting distributed.
Shit, I get caught out every single week. Oh, man, the algorithm hates us. The algorithm hates us. Click like, guys. Just keep clicking like. Anyway.
Shall we go back to the little creatures?
Yes, we go back to the miniatures, shall we?
Yes, okay, yes.
So obviously there's the Night Folk range that we were talking about, which is absolutely packed with all sorts of strange and weird and exotic creatures. Like, I think there's, if you can think of some weird thing that should belong in a fantasy game, they've probably got it here in some way. And I think one of the cool things about the Night Folk in particular is that it gives you a lot of ideas for kind of coming up with alternative campaigns and scenarios and stuff. Maybe you're playing skirmishing stuff, maybe you're playing role-playing games, that kind of thing. All the stuff here is kind of like an indicator for you to go, I wonder how I could build a scenario around that and that kind of thing. So the thing I also like about it as well is that while they've got sort of like a lot of sort of quirky and sort of old school miniatures in the mix, they've also got quite a lot of stuff that will be very good to use, I think anyway, with sort of younger gamers. So a lot of it is just a little bit absurd, it's a little bit weird and a little bit wacky. So it'd be a really nice way to do like an alternative set of D&D fighters or something that you're going to take on an adventure and things. So they've got some really good stuff. This is the other side of the Night Folk range. So this is the Night Folk hunters. So you've got the Night Folk that live out in the darkness, in the woods and the swamps and that kind of thing. And the other side of things, you've got the Night Folk hunters who go out to try and chase them down and hunt them down and stuff. And so here you can see some of their very awesome looking range that again has that kind of Henson-esque look to it. Also bringing in a lot of sort of old hammer style as well, which is really cool. And yes, some adorable miniatures, I guess would be a good way of saying it.
Think this would make a beautiful range of miniatures to use for an RPG, especially an RPG, family-based RPG. You know, I can imagine, like, you know, forget D&D. You could spin up a homebrew RPG off the back of this, no problem.
You could just do something with a handful of dice and some stuff, and you could create some interesting stuff for this.
Yeah, because imagine taking your little ones, you know, through an adventure where they're meeting the Night Folk and stuff like that, and you know, solving little puzzles and the likes. I think that'd be beautiful. And as you said, that Jim Henson kind of vibe. Like, look at the hero. How awesome is that?
That is an awesome little creature.
That is just awesome. So, like, that Jim Henson style to the whole thing, it just gives it such warmth. I'm looking at these miniatures, and just that sense of warmth, that sense of comfort. Now, it might be my my viewing habits through the years, you know, of loving Henson's work, you know, on Labyrinth and things like that. So maybe that's what's making me feel warm and gooey inside just looking at him. But I do feel warm and gooey inside just looking at it. I feel like an RPG set in this would be such a comforting and comfortable experience.
Yeah, like one of the things that I thought was quite interesting about, like when I saw this, one of my immediate sort of things was, what would you do for terrain for this? And immediately, even though it can fit into a lot of different genres, I was thinking that the Fabled Realms foreground stuff would be great.
Oh, still
a bit,
yeah.
Still a little bit heroic in its proportions and style, and a little bit quirky and weird. So it would be a really nice way to sort of tie the two together.
I'm telling you, this stuff would fit into anything. So if any of you guys are rocking the terrain that came with, what was that? What was that Warhammer Age of Sigmar kind of big box with the terrain in it? Warcry.
Yes.
Warcry. Yeah, Warcry came with a load of terrain. It would fit with that as well. I'll tell you what else it would fit with is the guys behind Malifaux, Weird, released some beautiful plastic terrain kits.
If you wanted to go down the weird and wonderful route with that.
That would fit beautifully with that as well. And then, of course, the Fabled Realms. You know, the Fabled Realms is perfect for this kind of thing. You know, it's I love it. I absolutely love it. Mm. But there's more, isn't there?
There is more, and now we move on to the set that I think you're going to go a little bit squee over, and that is the Time Robbers collection that they've put together here.
Oh! Whee! It's the Time Bandits! Oh, dude. Oh, just look at the character on their little faces. Mm-hmm. Oh, love it. Absolutely love it. And then they have Evil. There he is.
Good old Evil.
Man, what do they
do without him?
I need a version with him, like his umbrella out of his head.
Something you can convert yourself, get to.
There's John Cleese. Mm-hmm. And do they have Sean Connery? Is Sean Connery yes. in there? Oh, there he is! There he is!
Fighting the Minotaur.
And they have the giant that has the sore back. Oh, man, this is just, this is just so cool.
Mm-hmm. They are lovely chunky sculpts as well.
Oh. Now, there is an RPG. If ever there was one, Time Bandits would be an amazing RPG. Because I've been thinking about this since I brought it up the last time. Like, imagine the cool map. Right, so the whole RPG be centered around the map, and you and the kids, you want to get the map, let's look on the map. And the thing is, you could teach them so much about history, and because they're jumping around through time, you could pick periods of all sorts of stuff. You know, they could learn about, you know, the Spanish flu, the Black Death, you know, it's like leprosy. You know,
I sense the theme. Yeah.
I remember Kevin, but who's this pig beside Kevin? Oh, no, I'm not.
That was the one that got turned into a pig.
Who got turned into a pig? Oh, yes, that's right. Yes, one of the Time Bandits.
Yeah.
In the big fight at the end.
That's mm-hmm. it.
Don't have the microwave, mind you.
Nope.
So, this would be awesome. Because then, right, so let's say you're a gamer, a war gamer, and you have a bunch of historical minis already, right? You could suddenly use, even though they're on horrible square bases, most likely.
Beautiful, sweet square bases.
You could pull those historical minis into an RPG. So your little Time Bandits run into a Napoleonic unit, you know, or they meet up with Alexander the Great folk on a chariot or something,
yeah.
or some Celts. Or
I was painting these up. This week, they'd be perfect because the Time Bandits could come along and rob these guys.
And you know what? Even better than that, when the Time Bandits jump into their hole in the map, they would come up through that. That would be the exit point for their wormhole. Would come up. They would actually come out through the chest. I'm telling you, if nobody's already done it, it's mine. I'm doing it. Bandits RPG.
I like it when they jump through one of the holes and they come out one of the trap doors in the sky, because you could have a scatter thing where you just drop them somewhere.
Yeah, well, you wouldn't drop the minis. Maybe I would, but but definitely it'd be like Deep Strike. You just lift the Deep Strike rule out of 40K. Everybody loves that. So you just lift the Deep Strike rule out and your little time bandits Deep Strike all over the table. Yeah. Oh, I love you, Northumbrian Tin Soldier. I love you. This is great.
There's two more little collections that I wanted to look at as well. So the next one is called The Beard Folk. And as you might imagine, it's to do with dwarves, however you want to say it, Dawi. They are all here in their various forms. There's quite a lot of, you know, sort of classic looking dwarves, but they've also gone in and done some slightly more quirky and sort of original takes on them as well.
Do you think the algorithm will punish us if I say I like those lady beards?
No. I'm sure lady beards is a highly searchable term right now, I'm sure. So. Yeah.
Loving those lady beards.
We're going to get the wrong audience, but hey.
But no, one of the cool things about a lot of the dwarf characters that they do for this is that they tend to put little tiny snippets of like lore or something with them as well. Mm-hmm. And so like over on social media and on the store as well, they'll have like a little couple of lines of text that will be like, this is what this dwarf's all about. And so if when it came to you using them in a game, for example, or something in the future, you could be like, oh, I wonder how he works or how his character would be. You can use those as a little sort of trigger to carry on and do some cool stuff with it. So, yeah. And most of the lady dwarves have facial hair, which is always a plus. So there you go.
I'm sure.
There you go.
It's a Pratchettism.
It's a Pratchettism, yeah. Mm.
Love it. Yeah, really love it.
So, yeah, so those dwarves, actually, they'll mix in really nicely with the Nightfolk range and what you want to do with that as well. So, but obviously, as well, they could be used on their own to do something. Maybe you're going to be putting together a little bit of a skirmishing force. You need some leaders for your units and stuff. The thing I actually quite like about these is that they work really nicely alongside some of the, I think there's a company called Lead Adventure. I think that's a company. Mm-hmm. They work really nicely against those kind of their style of fantasy as well. So if you want to take some of the slightly larger units that they do or something and use these as characters, that would be a really nice sort of mix up and stuff. So, and the last set to look at is this wonderful little box set that I still have not claimed yet, but this is The Guardians of the Riverbank. And it's the characters from Wind in the Willows going up against those dastardly stoats and evil weasels that try to take over Toad Hall. So they've done a nice little set of character miniatures and then also the sort of villains of the piece as well. And the box set even comes with a set of dice so you can use them in some role-playing games as well.
Very nice. Sort of cool. Very nice. So I see Badger in there. I see Toady, Moly. It's great. I love the... What's the pipe-smoking dude?
He doesn't fall into my knowledge of the Wind in the Willows. Obviously, I know Ratty Moly...
he's in there.
Badger, but
isn't
it an otter?
It might be the otter. Yeah.
There you go. Well, guys, right, go and check out NorthumbriantinSoldier.com because if you want that warm, fuzzy feeling inside, that is where you go. Absolutely love it. Two thumbs up from me. And yes, I will start work after this episode on Time Bandits RPG Warren style.
See, Jerry's even got some of his own.
Have you got them?
Yeah. Of course Jerry has them. Jerry has every miniature ever available.
Behind this curtain is a wormhole and a Time Bandit thing. I want that. I just nip through and grab it.
Oh, awesome. Awesome. Right, guys, it's time to find out what's going on in the world.
Coming to you from the center of Northwestern Europe. Covering board games, war games, card games, and all that you love. It's the news.
Cool, yeah. So the first bit of news that we're going to be looking at is a return to some news from the Land of Games Workshop. And we start with a journey into the grim, dark future. And that is some previews for what's coming for Warhammer 40,000. So the first little bit of preview stuff that they shared for this was that there is going to be a new set of models coming out alongside the Pariah book. Now, we'd already seen some of them already. But this is a new character that's another renegade inquisitor. And this is Lord Inquisitor Kyria Draxus. So this is a rogue inquisitor who has decided that the weapons of the enemy are pretty good to use against the enemies that you're facing now.
That's Eldar weapons, isn't it?
Yeah, so she's got a shuriken catapult, and then she's also alongside the Drax... Sorry, not Draxus. I'll have to find out exactly the name of the creature because I don't want to forget it. It is a...
Tiny dragon.
Remember, a shang. That's it's what it's called.
Tiny shang. Wee dragon.
It's a shwang! Shwang! Okay, yeah.
So she also has the shang on her side there as well. Uh-huh. She is going up against the new sort of like nemesis for this particular book is Illuminor Zerus there, who's a new existing Necron Lord who's been given a little bit of an upgrade, as you can see. He has been trying to perfect the Necron race, the Necron tier, in as many ways as possible. And he's also found ways to siphon the psychic energies away from psychers as well. And so that's what you can see him doing here, pulling out the energy and the life force of that poor, unfortunate Imperial psyker there.
I thought that was blood.
It might also be blood as well. I don't know. But he's doing some cool, weird stuff with things to do with the sort of life force of the creatures and stuff like that.
Yeah.
But yeah. So
you can see some of the, now I don't know if they're separate sculpting teams or not between the Age of Sigmar guys and the 40K guys, but you can start to see some of the Age of Sigmar kind of little touches coming through into the sculpting here. That blood or whatever it is, it has tones of some of the sculpting and stuff that we have seen on the Age of Sigmar stuff for a while now. So it's cool. Necron's a tricky one, man, as a sculptor, like, because, you know, there's a number of fixed kind of tropes and design elements to the Necrons. Yeah. So, you know, I'm not sure how far you can steer from that.
I think when they did the full conversion over to the plastic stuff, I think they actually did a pretty good job of like making the Necrons feel different and new while also trying to keep a lot of the sort of Terminator aesthetic that they had in the past, you know, in the old sort of metal models they did and that kind of thing. So I think they did a good job of that. Then they kind of went a little bit sort of jumped the shark with a lot of stuff they did later on with the Necrons, I think. But for the most part, I like the fact that they're giving a little bit more personality and stuff like that. And they've got all the different Necron lords who have their own ideas of how they want to progress the Necron race and stuff going forward. But those two characters are joined by Ephril Stern and Kynegil that we looked at in a preview not long ago, maybe 2 weeks ago now, which is also going to be for Pariah as well. So there's a lot of models coming in as part of Pariah. They are also, before Pariah, there's also going to be another Psychic Awakening book, which is called The War of the Spider, which we've already talked about, which will focus on Fabius Bile, or Fabius, because that's how I've always said it. So if you want to dive in and check out those two books, they should be coming as soon as Games Workshop start to fire things up again, I would assume.
Yeah.
But we'll have to see how that all comes together, because obviously there's a lot of catching up to do when it comes to the world of Warhammer 40K and Age of Sigmar right now. As well as the stuff for the mainline 40K storyline and how that's been developing, there's also going to be the final expansion for Warhammer Quest Blackstone Fortress. And this is a new expansion which will look at it's called Ascension. And this is going to be like the final big climactic moments for Warhammer Quest on the tabletop. You're going to take your crew and you're going to be heading out into the Blackstone Fortress once again to try and stop the deadly Obsidious Malex, which is his name. That's the Chaos Lord from the original, if you remember him. Stop him and his sort of like machinations in the background. But this also means that as you delve deeper into the Blackstone Fortress, you've also awakened something there as well. And the Guardian drones, who are these big, huge mechanical creatures, are going to be stomping out throughout the Blackstone Fortress to try and hunt you down. So if you want to get in and play through the very final moments of what's happening with the Blackstone Fortress and Warhammer Quest, then that's something to dive into and play as well. So it'd be very interesting to see what they do next with this, because obviously they came out with Warhammer Quest Silver Tower, which, you know, wasn't great, wasn't too bad. It was sort of middling of a game. Then they came out with Shadows Over Hammerhull, which was the sort of like expansion to that, which allowed you to have one person playing as the bad guy and stuff. Then they kind of reinvented stuff again anyway when they came back to Warhammer Quest with Blackstone Fortress, and that seems to have pretty much gone down wholeheartedly quite well. A lot of people tend to enjoy it. Really nice models, really nice expansions, all that kind of thing that have had a lot of applications into 40K as well. But maybe we'll see them go back to fantasy and try something again with Age of Sigmar in the future for this. But we'll see.
What's an RPG video?
So this is just a little cool teaser video that they put, which has some cool sort of audio in the background as well about the teams from Precipice going out to hunt down the whatever deadly stuff is happening within the Blackstone Fortress at the moment. And you can see just the scale of the Guardian drones there as well, which are actually pretty towering. So
big dudes, aren't they? Yeah.
Yeah. It's also interesting again to see something that's so alien and different from what we've seen in 40K before as well, because obviously the Guardian drones and stuff in there are something that we've not really seen, you know, 140,000 have before. Obviously the Necrons have got a little bit more in that direction now, but they're very, very cool, and it's nice to see a little bit more of that kind of lore in the background being pulled to the fore.
Okay.
Just need Superman to crush one on your flank.
Exactly, yeah, actually. on the other side of things for 40K, so we're still sticking with this, there's still a few more bits and pieces. There's a couple of new models that were shown off. So the first of these is a character from Horus Heresy that I'm sure Justin somewhere is crying out and going, oh my God, I can't believe he's here. This is amazing. This is Saul Tarvitz.
Very good, Justin.
I thought for a moment Justin was here.
who is from the Horus Heresy there. So he's quite a famous character from the
I'm books. Thinking John will be screaming more about this because he loves painting his men purple.
Yeah,
he does actually. Yeah,
Tarvitz was a badass, absolute badass. I enjoyed Soul's stories as well. So,
yeah. And then, as well as the model there for the Horus Heresy, there's two special miniatures. Now, obviously, Games Workshop, as we talked about last week, aren't doing any selling of any of their stuff right now, but they are also taking some made to order offers, as well as doing that £50 voucher thing that you can do and all that kind of malarkey. But there are two miniatures they're doing specifically on a made-to-order thing. So you've got Sister Tariana Palos here, who is based on the artwork from one of the Sisters of Battle books that came out last year, which is looking very, very cool indeed. And then there is also a Terminator-armored librarian called Lexicanum Varos. It was a show-exclusive miniature that was meant to be given out at things like Adepticon and that kind of thing, and Gen Con and stuff. But obviously, with the world as it is right now, they are giving him away as part of the made to order system, so everyone can order him, and then they will be sent out, shipped out to everybody as soon as the crisis is over, and Games Workshop will fire everything back up when it comes to their factories and stuff. So yeah, some really cool stuff there for 40K, especially if you're following along with the storyline, which I know a lot of people are, for Psychic Awakening. So cool stuff there.
Okay, fantasy, this is the one I'm looking forward to.
Yes, so on the fantasy side of things, there was also a bunch of new previews that came out over the weekend. And one of the big reveals they had a couple of weeks ago was for the Sons of Bayomat. And Bayomat is a massive god beast from the world of Age of Sigmar that is like a continent-sized creature. But some of his spawn, his children, are the Gargants, or the Giants, as they used to be called in Warhammer Fantasy. And this is a couple. This was a preview of three new ways you can build the different Giants for Warhammer Age of Sigmar.
Nice.
I really like these. They're very, very cool. I think they've got some really nice sort of detail and stuff going into them. I really quite liked the Warhammer Fantasy sort of Giant they did a little while back as well.
These are twice the height of the Fantasy Giant, well, aren't they?
This is when their love of skulls come into use. Because you can use skulls to figure out how big he is.
Exactly, yeah. So they stand about another sort of arm and shoulder head above normal giants from the range of from Games Workshop, which I believe the originals are called the Ale Guzzler Giants, not Gargants, sorry, whereas these have three different names. So here you've got the, and I'm going to find the names for them, so don't forget them.
Is there more pictures?
Yeah, more pictures.
So you've got the Gatebreaker, the War Stomper, and the Kraken Eater.
I like three, that one there.
Giants. So yeah, I believe that's the
And you can build all three of them from the one kit.
Yeah, so they're all from one kit. You can build each of them. So yeah.
Let's see this last one. That's cool.
I think he's very cool. There's something a little bit more of like the sort of Heresy miniature style to that one, which I think was really interesting. There's a little bit more of that style going on in there, which was really cool. But yeah, if you're interested in playing as an entire army of giants, you can do that now. Although
really?
So it's going to be you could do an entire army just of giants if you wanted to, which is the way they've been posting this together. But also they've talked about the idea that because of the Gargants and the Sons of Bayomat don't have any particular allegiance, apart from sort of being within, you know, the realm of destruction and stuff, most armies can basically just pick one up and add them to their army. So if you want to hire one as a mercenary for your army, you can do that. So
this is my
it's not going to be that you're going Yeah, you're not going to come up against just a bunch of people playing just giant armies. You'll just have giants everywhere, basically, now.
To feel like a, yeah. To feel like a Jerry.
That's what we all want in our heart of hearts. Yeah. As well as the giants previews, there was also another preview for Warcry. Mm-hmm. And that is that there's going to be the first of their warbands that is not specifically...
is that further down here?
Chaos.
Yes, yeah, further down. Yeah, it's not specifically Chaos. This is the Kainite Shadowstalkers. So they are a group of dark elves or elves from the realm of shadow that have headed out to try and do Kane's good work, which obviously means murdering people in as many different ways as possible. And as you can see here, some very, very cool looking models. I'm not entirely... I'm okay when I think about the cloaks as actually being magical. But then when you see some of them are actually real, but then not real, I think some of the ways that it's been put together are kind of a bit weird. And a couple of people brought that up in the comments as well. But I think the overall look of them is very cool. And I think it's really nice to see another warband in the game that isn't just chaos focused. Because it kind of brings forward the idea that maybe we're going to see some stuff in the future for all the other different factions that have been involved in Warcry, where they're all going to get their own unique boxes rather than just have to draw from the range and buy lots of different boxes to make one warband and stuff. So that'd be kind of cool.
What do you mean their cloaks are real but not real?
So if you look at that guy, he's got a, you know, his cloak looks perfectly real and physical and within the realm of possibility.
Is it just being projected out of that gemstone or what?
Possibly, that's the thing. Because if you then look at some of the other, if you look at some of the other characters, they actually have their cloaks fading into like a mirror, sort of mirage kind of thing, which is kind of interesting. So it looks a bit weird, but I'm sure some people will do some really nice stuff with it when it comes to painting and stuff. But
it's like having a whole army of spawns.
Yes, it is actually.
It's weird because the cloak's goal sort of, it starts out sort of angular and then it goes a bit more curvy.
Glowing.
Ripply.
Ripply.
So it's an interesting effect, but it's certainly very cool as well. If you like your kind of backstabby elves, then it's, you know, pretty much...
Everybody loves really, backstabby elves. I will admit now, I'm starting to get a little bit lost with all of the different releases and ranges and things like that. You know, it's there's an awful lot going on, and I'm starting to feel a little bit lost. You know, because when you start talking about new box sets specifically for Warcry, but from the world of Age of Sigmar, rather than just drawing from the minis and stuff that are there in the range, I'm beginning to go, It's all starting to sound like a lot of hard work, man.
Yeah, you've heard it here first. They should destroy the world again and go for Sigmar 2.
Old World 2, Lloyd. Old World 2. So, right, what else have we got? Have we any normal elves? Did I see the beginnings of some normal elf stuff?
Nothing normal about them.
In the final sort of preview they did show off another miniature for the Lumineth Realm Lords, which are the elves that have been reborn as under Teclis. And so this is one of the new characters that they've been working on for that. She's one of the sort of casters within their army. Her sort of whole shtick, because everyone has to have a cool shtick that isn't just drawing magic from the ether, she feeds off the emotions of her race and then uses it to affect her enemies. So she draws in all of the malice and melancholy of the elves and uses it against her foes.
Why is she wearing an ornate coat hanger?
Because she needs somewhere to hang her tassels. So
I've seen those before, though.
You've seen that ornate coat hanger thing before. I've seen other places you can hang tassels.
In fact, I think it may be Mongolian or something like that.
It is very much one of those kind of like Eastern themes, I think.
Yeah.
Good luck painting that face.
Yes.
Well, that's the thing. It's going to be very interesting what people do with that. Yeah. So.
I would just paint it blue and be done.
Yeah, could do.
Her glass of wine shows that she has her priorities right anyway. So.
Very true. Yeah.
Who else? Anything else, or is that the only one?
That's the only thing that showed off.
It's a bit like Big Trouble in Little China. The whole headdress thing going on there.
That is true. Oh,
I know where I've seen something like that before. Padme. Queen Amidala wears weird stuff like that.
Just kind of, yeah, I suppose. Yeah.
So, okay, right. We have the Snotlings, yes?
Yes. So this was probably my favorite little preview from what they did over the weekend. And this is a full-blown Snotling team for use in Blood Bowl. Now, Snotlings, and I can attest to this, are terrible at Blood Bowl. I have played them in stunty leagues. I have played them in normal leagues of Blood Bowl. They are absolutely
How
shit.
Many trolls?
I ended up with I had two trolls in the end. They ended up killing more. They ended up killing more. They ended up killing more snotlings than they did actually helping me.
That's fine. It's the same as halfling teams. You don't run a halfling team without three tree men. You don't run a snotling team without three trolls.
You need something to go on the front line before they get squished. But there's a really nice characterful snotling team that they've put together there. All of them unique little sculpts that you can play around with and have a lot of fun painting, which is really nice. And if you are just losing every game, you could always throw in the snotling pomp wagon, which is shown further down as well, which we'll hopefully get to in a second. But
it's a snot room or a mushling.
Some really nice stuff there. I really like that the guys who are working on the Blood Bowl stuff have done the halflings in a little bit more detail and now the snotlings, because it's kind of building on this idea that Blood Bowl is that kind of like fun game that everyone can play and sort of get stuck into. And if you are just, you know, a sucker for punishment, you can play this and try and beat the other teams. You will not win, but you can give it a go. So
Right. Awesome stuff. Right. Next up, our Justin got a chance to sit down with Carlos from Corvus Belli to try and get us a preview, inside scoop on Infinity CodeOne.
Hello, everybody, and welcome. I am joined in the studio by the magnificent, the mighty Carlos from Corvus Belli. Carlos, welcome, buddy. It's always a pleasure. How you
it
doing, buddy?
It would be if I could travel again to Northern Ireland, but, you know, it goes like this.
Oh, I know. How are you holding up? You staying safe over there?
Oh, yes. I mean, coronavirus has hit Spain hard, but in the northwest, in Galicia, it's not that dramatic. Mm. We still are in lockdown quarantine and stuff like that, but... Mm-hmm. It's not that dramatic here.
Yeah, no, we're kind of the same up here on the north coast of Ireland. I think we've got like one of the lowest case counts in the UK, which is kind of good. But we're not here for Corona. We're here for CodeOne, because you guys have some exciting new stuff coming and happening, yeah?
Yeah, CodeOne. Well, yes, I mean, now that the boxes of Operation Karlstrom are arriving to the first customers and stuff like that, we are publishing as a PDF file free for to download, and we are updating the army app for CodeOne. Mm-hmm. So people next Monday are going to be able to download a 96 pages PDF file which has the rules for the whole CodeOne game. It's a game. Mm-hmm. It's a game on its own. It's not Infinity 4th edition. It's not that. It's not Infinity whatever. It's a game on its own. Mm-hmm. So people will get familiar with the rules. People will notice that the rules are very familiar to them, but at the same time, there's not this thing, or there's not that stuff. Or, you know, it's like a streamlined version, a reduced version in a certain way that keeps the game in a very pure, very, very beginner-friendly form, okay? Mm-hmm. Recently, I was checking out the PDF file, and when I look at the states and the markers on the states, suddenly I realize, this just this few, the most basic and essential ones, you know, mm-hmm. when someone is unconscious, when someone is prone, when someone is targeted, when someone is camouflaged, when someone is, very, very, just the most essential one, immobilized, stuff like that. But it's not like a lot of them, which is what we have reached at this last month of N3. We have lots of states, for example. Mm-hmm. I'm just giving an example here. So, yeah, and the army app, you know, the essential tool that everybody uses to make army lists, on Monday will update. And we have a new button, and that button is CodeOne. Mm-hmm. So people will be able to make lists with a new mathematical context, okay? With units just costing 1 point or 2 points or 3 points, you know, like not 15, 17, the 34, you know, mm-hmm. is different. And a reduced number of available units, yep. Okay? So composing army lists for 15-point battles, which is the size of Operation Karlstrom, or 25-point battles or 30-point battles, you know. Mm-hmm. So I'm very excited about this. I truly mean it. And this coronavirus is totally screwing the moment.
everybody is feeling it, man. You have no idea.
Oh, Adepticon didn't happen, and I was so willing to go to the USA again.
Mm. But trust me, that makes two of us. I was really looking forward to doing some of the American cons this year, looking forward to doing Essen. Like, Salute, UK Games Expo, all those big names.
Yeah. The cool thing is that now that everybody's in lockdown, they will have this PDF file with this new game to chew, okay, to read and to begin to make their own mind games, okay, because it could be very cool. It's beautiful to see, like, Infinity beginning again, like again going back to the first edition, because this sent me very powerful energy vibes of the first time I played Infinity, okay? So it's like, oh, wow, this game, okay, this unit and this unit and this unit, this is my army list, and will behave like this, and I'm going to play like this, and there's just very, very affordable stuff regarding the volume of rules and units and options that you have there.
Yeah, it brings everything back into like a nice condensed smaller mind space so that you can really work the meta. This is something whenever we first saw this was coming, Carlos, we had a nice long discussion about it on one of the Weekender shows. I mean, like, I love the idea that everything's getting pared back to the absolute essentials. I really think you're probably going to see some of your hardcore gamers are going to dive into this hard and maximize everything, and I cannot wait to see what they come up with. I love what you've done with the actual starter set, especially the redesign you've done for some of the terrain in the box. Looks absolutely fantastic.
Yeah, but what I really want, and it's not going to happen at least these days because everything is in lockdown, is new players and new communities being, you know, gathering around this
new
game.
Jump off point.
You know, yeah, because it will be is very beginner friendly, especially for the stores and distributors, because that now this new line of products with these black boxes is the new Infinity thing. Consider this, because we have been dealing through many years with new stores or new distributors who arrive suddenly at Infinity and says, okay, what should I get? And among the whole ocean of options of the Excel files, okay, there was no label that totally distinguishes what's essential and what is hardcore deep down in the game.
Yeah. If they were diving in, they would need to have the metagamer and Infinity metagamer on staff to pick out everything.
Yeah. But now we are totally branding and labeling these SKUs, these new boxes that are black and vertical boxes. So newcomers will know immediately that is CodeOne, and that is the best gateway to Infinity. And you can enjoy it as a game on its own, you know, and collect month by month your army SKUs, your army products. Okay, yeah. With the new remos, with the new super pack stuff, and go slowly into playing with other players that are, you know, newcomers also. Of course, veterans will also get into this just to have the pleasure of solving the algorithm, the mathematics, what is the best unit that costs just 2 points, and they will check all of them and say this one is the better. Therefore, I'm making this army because I will take this guy. You know, stuff like that.
At some point,
coming with the list that always wins. You know, everybody wants to find that. Okay,
yeah, that's gaming. You know, that's what we do. We love doing it. But speaking of armies, I love the fact that you've picked up Pano and the Yujing for the two starter factions in this box, and the miniatures look absolutely gorgeous in this set.
Well, Pano and Yujing have been rivals since the beginning. It was one of those rivalries that even the fans like to role play, and they never been together in a box. In fact, when we released in 2014 Operation Ice Storm, people was asking, why Pano against Nomads when the obvious rivalry is Pano against Yujing? But there were many decisions that took us to make that box like that. So everybody wanted blue against orange, not red against blue, you know, but it's happening now in Svartheimer.
Yeah. Now, here's an important question. So we're coming into CodeOne. It's a new way for people to jump in. If I'm a veteran player and I'm grabbing some of these CodeOne miniatures, am I able to use them in Infinity as well? Are they going to cross over?
Yes. The Operation Karlstrom allows you to go directly into Infinity CodeOne or jump then later into M4. Mm-hmm. Everything is playable, okay? By creating Infinity CodeOne, we're creating also a context where new players can gather around, okay, without jumping into the hardcore tournament meta, okay? Mm-hmm. That's a safe space. We made a safe space for newcomers, okay? Mm-hmm. And they don't have to digest all the armies and all the units and all the rules and all the options. They will have that context where they can understand the basics and play the basics and begin to lose their battles and then begin to win their battles and then begin to understand what is really bringing the punch to the table, okay? And what way they could handle the units and how they should behave in reactive turn also. Mm-hmm. Because that's the learning how to deploy, learning how to behave in the reactive turn. That's something that nobody can teach you. You have to experience that. Mm-hmm. And CodeOne is the bootcamp for that, okay?
Yeah. Well, I mean, like I do remember Infinity when it first landed on the market many, many moons ago. You know, the very idea of an ARO coming across on paper, it just doesn't come across on paper. But as soon as you see it, bang, you understand, and it makes the game so much more fun.
Oh, well, it was not that easy. For years, many people was questioning what we were doing because we were a small company. Mm-hmm. Later, when the company became successful, big marks here, then people stopped questioning. But believe me that after all these years, many people was in, the game is too dependent on terrain. It's wrong. Change it. This army makes no sense. It's wrong. Change it. These rules make no sense. They are wrong. Mm. No game can work like this. Change it. You know, that was 2008 or whatever. You know. Mm. Now, after so many years, I'm having a hardcore community and hardcore tournament players and everything like that. They just ask for more power for their armies, as it should be, you know.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Well, again, back to armies, back to the power of the armies. Who are the chosen ones for CodeOne?
Yeah. We, from the beginning, decided not to put all the factions on the armies in CodeOne. It has to be very, very simple, because we don't want to overcome, put too much stuff to make the player be totally
you don't want
blind.
To overload.
Overwhelm, that is the word that I was looking for. Overwhelm the player with too many armies and options, mm-hmm. and also stores and distributors.
Of course.
Whom some of them might be shy regarding this new game. And suddenly you tell them, no, we have 10 factions and 40 armies. And it's like, okay, now.
How many SKUs?
Four armies. Mm-hmm. And month by month, you will be collecting the SKUs. Mm-hmm. Now, Karlstrom, then the super pack, then the remotes, then the, so it's not like a huge investment and you still don't know what is going to happen. It's like, no, we will make things slowly, very beginner friendly, and people will play more and more challenging games, mm-hmm. okay, growing and having fun while learning that. Mm-hmm. That is the best way to make a new edition. Okay.
Yeah, so you're going to run with like a slow grow feel to this then as you actually release your product codes.
Yeah, in fact, yes, because, well, the newcomers don't have the tags yet. We have released a few miniatures, and they have the action packs of O12 and Sasbasti, and they have Operation Karlstrom, but they have no tags. Mm-hmm. Tags will have their moment during the year. At some point, they will arrive, and they will change the mini-meta of mm-hmm. CodeOne, suddenly playing with tags, you know.
Yeah.
So, I'm more units are hidden, waiting for the moment in the year to appear in CodeOne and to jump into the spotlight and suddenly be something in CodeOne. So it's going to be pretty exciting. And I know that the veterans are all about M4 and thinking about M4, the fourth edition of the game, you know, that is going to satisfy very specific needs of very deep into tournament meta players. I think that the success, the revenue, the thing that brings Corvus Belli back into the industry in a certain way is CodeOne, mm-hmm. because that is the vehicle to make new stores and new players get into the Corvus Belli world, okay? Mm-hmm. And I think that we're doing it. The only thing that we didn't expect is the whole quarantine coronavirus. It's like, what?
Here's your plans. Off the rails.
Yeah.
See, I love the idea
anyway,
that it's guided.
Something that makes us be not in panic is like war games with monthly releases like Infinity are not Kickstarters, you know. If a Kickstarter suddenly is published in a bad moment, for whatever reason, the whole initiative, the whole project is totally destroyed. It's very, very painful. But for Corvus Belli with Infinity, because we are releasing month after month stuff, and it's an ongoing train of releases, you know, a bad month doesn't matter because the rest of the year will balance it. A bad moment, a moment of unpopularity, everything kind of flows. It's not depending on just one specific week, just one specific month. No, it comes. And that is what allowed the company always to react and to adapt to whatever the customer needs, to whatever the fan base was asking for or the tournament meta was needing, you know. So it's different. It's not so depending.
That one golden moment.
Sorry, what?
That one golden moment. You're not relying on it.
Yeah.
I mean, like, from what I'm seeing and from what I'm hearing from you, Carlos, it feels as if as people are playing through the year, as the new things are coming out, everybody's getting new stuff, but it's similar new stuff. So they're all learning the same kinds of new tactics. You know, how does my tag play against your tag? You're both doing it around the same time. It's not the old arms race of, oh crap, he's got a tag, I need to get a tag, my tag's not as good as his tag, damn it.
The flavor, the devil is in the details. Suddenly the Sasbasti players at some point will realize that their tag is better, you know, because it's thermo-optical camo and, you know, has certain advantages. Or the panel will say, no, our tag is better. But in the context of your army, your tag is better because you can support it with hidden hackers or stuff like that. And we don't have that stuff. Everybody will make that. That is, I don't want to spoil it. That is the beautiful thing to, after a few games and studying the rules, and this time is less than 100 pages, it's just a little book of rules. Understanding the new context and suddenly solving and saying, oh, I have a formula, a winning formula here. This is my winning formula. Okay, let's make it fight against your winning formula. You know, it's beautiful. It's like a puzzle that everybody will enjoy solving.
Well, I mean, like, I cannot wait to see what happens with this and how people play about with it. You know, I'm looking forward to seeing what the Eugene get. They were always my favorite. I'm going to hold my hands up to it. Eugene number one.
Okay. So now what we are announcing this weekend is that next Monday, the PDF file of that 96 pages of CodeOne rules will be published and public. People can begin to enjoy and to digest and to read page after page and realizing how this pure, streamlined, clean version of Infinity works. At the same time, the app will update and people will be allowed to make their army lists, okay, and suddenly check out which units and which loadouts are available for playing with. So why don't we take a look at the army lists for Pano, Yuching, O12 and Sasbasti also, which people, well, combined army, people have not seen those yet.
Let's start with the O12, shall we?
Okay, O12 is something that people is not yet aware. I don't know if this has been published yet or hitting the webs. It's very, very fresh information from Corvus Belli, okay? So O12 army list, we can see there the three columns, okay? The one on the left is the units, the one in the center is the super units, and the one on the right is the characters, okay? And I see a mistake over there anyway. Kappa units are the basic line infantry. Delta units are like jump troopers, okay? They can execute combat jump. Epsilon units are usually the best sniper for O12. Beta troopers is like a robot that has climbing plus and has a very good movement. Gangmasters are skirmishers. Gamma units and Omega units are elite heavy infantries. Lynx units Okay, Razor units, Psycops, this is new. This is a new unit that people is not aware of. And Zeta units, which is the tag for all 12. Okay. Mm-hmm. So there you have your soldiers. Everybody is good at something. And Zeta unit, the Zeta unit is the rock that you smash the table with. Okay. Mm-hmm. On the center column, you have the Lambda, Doctor and Engineer. Pretty common in Infinity having the support pack with the Doctor, the Engineer, and the Jude bots in this occasion is that little remote helpers for O12. Jude bots comes from Aleph because if you are familiar with Infinity, you will realize that O12 uses a lot of Aleph equipment. Mm-hmm. In fact, Aleph uses the O12 equipment, really. And then you have there the generic remotes, the copper bots. Okay, Kita, Pillar, Medicine, and Oko, as usual. Combi rifle and many abilities. Total reaction, smart missile launcher, and repeater are the usual four options of the generic remotes. Everybody will have this, okay? Mm-hmm. Then you have the characters over there. Cuervo Goldstein is a character from U12 that was already included in the Beyond Wildfire box. Okay, Casanova, NCO Operative, that is new. Okay, new character. Catherine Cho was introduced to Infinity players in the Kickstarter Defiance campaign. Mm-hmm. It's a playable character in Defiance. Now they know that she is also playable in CodeOne. Hippolyta was the pre-order model from Operation Wildfire. It's a character that is playable also in Aristeia. Crashers, that is not a hero, that is a unit. Okay, Crashers from the O12, that is the special naval demolition team. Okay, that was a very recent addition to the list. And Lian Kai, one edition online monk, which is the pre-order miniature for Operation Kallstrom. Okay, mm-hmm. So it's a Shaolin monk, very dangerous.
Yeah. So basically, you're getting a full rundown on that one little image of just what's happening with O12, who's coming to the party.
Yeah, because there are already in the market a few more existing O12 units, but they are not available in CodeOne. Mm-hmm. And during this year, Corvus Belli will release more O12 units, but these that you can see in this image here are the ones that have been chosen for being available in CodeOne, okay? Mm-hmm. That's it. That's all I can say. I'm not revealing anything about the upcoming super new releases for the rest of the year, because Corvus Belli keeps on working, okay? The coronavirus is here, okay, fine. Everybody is working from home and stuff like that, but the plan stays the same, okay? Mm-hmm. And we have tons of stuff yet to deliver to the fans and to everybody who gets interested now and who is not a fan, who is just interested. Hey, this looks cool, and now it's easier than ever to jump in. Mm-hmm. They have the free app and the free rules, and they can just tweak and begin to understand how this goes. Mm-hmm. We are publishing another battle report, these new battle reports made with 3D stuff, which are fun to see. Mm-hmm. So I hope everybody gets excited about it, really.
Mm-hmm. All right, well, how about we then talk about the Pano? You know, what are they going to be bringing to the party for this game?
Okay, we can see Pano here. People was introduced early in this year when we were talking about Pano being released in Operation Kallstrom. Of course, the veterans were just interested in seeing the Svalarheima sectorial, and the CodeOne Pano roster of available units has a lot of Svalarheima units. You can see there the Fusiliers, the Nauken, the Kamau, the Bargar maximum security unit, the Akalisi commandos, the Svalarheima Nises, the Infirmaries of San Lazarus, the Orc troops, the Boy Soldiers, Knights of Justice, which is the most impressive miniature from the Operation Kallstrom set box, mm-hmm. Aquila Guard and Seas Guard, super elite heavy infantry. And then you have the Cutter as the tag, the Locust, clandestine action team, Crocman, classic Infinity unit there, and then the Engineer, the Doctor, the Helper drones, and the usual generic remotes. Finally, in the characters or special units column, we can see there the guy from the Dire Force box, Gunnar Landmark with the Troll Hunter, the Ankai, the one that is only Monk, and the Kunai Solutions Ninjas, which are the mercenary ninjas. Mm-hmm. So that's the roster of available units for Pano, which is a bit bigger than the O12. I can see more options over there, but mm-hmm. everybody will get around this amount of units.
Well, I mean, like, it's something with the game, because it's a new game, it's going to take time to grow into itself, so people just need to be ready for those releases to come and hit.
Shall we check now the combined army CodeOne army list, because this one is special. Okay, the Sarbasti were a super fan favorite sectorial army last year, last year when Operation Wildfire was released. Okay, everybody was expecting them to get into spotlight. Mm. And as you can see here, the selection of units for the combined army is mostly Sarbastis. Okay. Mm. So we can see here the Sarbasti Nox troops, which are the usual basic profile for the line infantry for the Sarbasti. And then we have the Tensho experts, the Mentors, the Jade Cutthroats, the Noctifers, which are terrifying, especially for ARO unit, the Caliban, the Sphinx, which is the tag, the Wailos, heavy infantry for the Sarbasti, the Shrouded and the Malignos, classic skirmishers here. And then the generic remote column with the slave drones and the medtech, mm-hmm. combined army support pack, classic units, and the drones. Okay, notice that we don't have there the e-drone, okay, which is an option that people will play in Infinity M3 and M4, but not in CodeOne, okay, mm-hmm. because the hacker skills and programs do not reach the Evo repeaters, okay, so that is more advanced. Mm-hmm. Then in the column of characters we have there Shargosh, Tunnel Crumbler of the Jade Cutthroats, a new character, people doesn't know about this guy. Shishkin, okay. Initially we were just going to have the Beyond Wildfire light infantry version of Shishkin. With Defiance we launch a heavy infantry with her, but for CodeOne we stick just with the light infantry. Okay. Mm-hmm. Victor Messer is a character that is involved in many shady plot twists in the Infinity
yeah, I remember Infinity seeing it.
Timeline and storytelling. Okay, then Nourkias is highlighted there as a character, so it's a very infamous evil character from the Combined Army, and is there. Kodali, also a very character that is is present on the table, is powerful in the gameplay, but people also know her from certain moments of the Infinity storytelling moments, okay, mm-hmm. of history. And finally, Agent Dukash, Bashar Special Corps. So we have there like three new names totally for the fans here, mm-hmm. to consider, you know, an Umbra and two more Sarbastis appearing in the operations theater here. Mm-hmm. So those are playable for CodeOne, and they are part of the release schedule of Corvus Belli for 2020 and 2021 release.
Nice. Well, I mean, like, I'm guessing for anybody jumping into this game, the advice is pick the faction you like the look of. You know.
Oh, of course. Infinity always have worked very well with that approach. Mm-hmm. You know, pick what you like aesthetically. I mean, we're very proud of our miniatures. We want every single one of the miniatures look lovely, mm-hmm. and so people cannot hesitate or cannot
resist.
Usually the problem is that everybody wants their army to be more powerful, you know, mm-hmm. but not like the, I'm so unhappy unsatisfied with the quality of the miniatures. No, everybody loves them.
And I mean, like, over the years I've seen the sculpting improvement. Whenever we first saw your miniatures, they were drop dead gorgeous. Now they're even more drop dead gorgeous. And speaking of drop dead gorgeous, let's have a look at the Yujing.
Well, Yujing, this army list was already introduced also during the Operation Kamstrom theme week of videos, you know, those usual theme weeks that we make sometimes with you, which of war, sometimes we have to make them on our own. Mm-hmm. But, you know, lots of content and lots of stuff to digest here for the people. We have can see here Sanxi and Sanjing Imperial Agents, Tiger Soldiers, Handong, Ambush Unit. Maybe the Handong is going to be the unit in the cover of the next book. We are considering that. We love that miniature. Jemao, mm-hmm. Infantry, Sujon Invincibles, Jianghu Invincibles, Sanchi Invincibles, lots of Invincibles. Yujak Regiment, everybody was paying attention to this miniature because it's the first Korean heavy infantry for Yujing, and people got a lot of attention there. Dao Fei Tactical Section, Hao Kao Special Units, Haktao, Xin Warriors, Elite Heavy Infantry, absolutely. The Blue Wolf, and we have already designed it, and we have already made a lovely cover with the Blue Wolf. Stay tuned. At some point, you will see it.
Oh, okay. I want to see it now.
I don't have it here. It's going. It's very cool. It has a lot of similarities with the Gitchia in terms of design, but then it has its own flavor. Everybody will be happy with it.
Awesome.
Gila and Skirmishers, my favorite unit these days. And the usual support units, the generic Jao Kongs and the Doctor and Engineer and the little helper drone bots, okay? Jao Saos. Jin Q, the Shadow Huang Di, this character that comes in the Beyond Operation Kallstrom, okay? Imperial Agent Adid Mehmood, a Special Division, a character that is get a lot of spotlight during this year, and I don't know, don't say why, but he's going to have a lot of... you know, attention on him. Mm-hmm. Okay. Liang Kai, Wandering Shaolin Monk, and the Kunai Solutions Ninjas. Okay. The two miniatures from pre-ordering Operation Kallstrom. So, yeah. And we are still hiding a few cards up our sleeve.
Of course you are, Carlos. Of course you are.
So a few more units are waiting for having their moment and suddenly surprise everyone. Mm-hmm. During this 2020 year of the beginning of CodeOne. Mm-hmm. So, fingers crossed, in order to people have more free time and being able to go to stores and play the game and buy it online, play it at home, whatever, so they can jump into an easy, you know, easy to read and understand, difficult to master version of Infinity.
Mm-hmm. I'm looking forward to seeing where it goes. So basically people need to keep their eyes peeled on April 27th for that new rulebook then, yeah?
Oh, yeah, absolutely. Mm-hmm. But, you know, especially if CodeOne is going to please a lot of veterans who left the game at some point and maybe are considering coming back, CodeOne also will feel like a new shoes for them. Mm-hmm. Absolutely, because they will be familiar with the rules but not having to chew the most advanced versions of it. Okay. Mm-hmm. They will understand and begin to solve logical problems and tactical situations immediately. And also newcomers who are so important and so necessary in mm-hmm. order to keep the flow of having Corvus Belli releasing miniatures and keeping more people excited every month, you know.
Definitely. Well, Carlos, what else can we say? I mean, like, I hope it does really well for you guys because, you know, you guys are one of the oldest companies that we've worked with through the years, and I have always loved what you guys make. So, me, just a personal note for myself, I wish you guys all the best with this project, man.
Yeah, I mean, I think we need luck right now because of the incredible situation that everybody is seeing we are into these days, you know. Mm-hmm. Spain is especially having a bad time with this situation, but you know, let's hope it passes and
fingers crossed, man. We have a saying over here, Carlos, this too shall pass. It might pass like a kidney stone, but it'll pass. All right, well, everybody, I tell you what, get your comments in below. Tell us, are you excited for Infinity CodeOne?
Check out Infinity Corvus Belli social media, the new website infinityuniverse.com, the Corvus Belli online store, the Infinity website, whatever platform you will find us there, okay? Mm-hmm. Instagram, YouTube, whatever, we will be there. And check out the links for arriving at the CodeOne website and being able to download the assets, okay? Check out the PDF file with the rules and also the army list maker, okay, that will help you to build your best first list of CodeOne with the new mathematics, okay. Mm-hmm. and enjoy and try the game and try with people around the maybe your apartment, okay, but just for a few days, okay.
You see, I just imagine someone sitting playing it with their cat.
Yeah.
Well, everybody, I tell you what, are you going to play with friends, family, your cat, your parrot? Myself and Carlos will move on. We'll see you again soon.
Even more news, bitches. Right, back for some more news. Well, Jerry, why don't you give us a bit of your Jerriness?
A bit of my Jerriness. I don't know if you can take only a bit of my Jerriness.
I would practice.
Here's a giant. That wasn't Freudian, by the way. may not have been able to see that. I had Jerry and Megan at the time.
Okay, Jerry, give it to us.
First up is moving into World War II and some stuff from Offensive Miniatures. They've been previewing a couple of new packs. So the first one is not the tank, but the fellas on the tank.
Tank riders.
Yeah, so Fallschirmjäger tank riders. If anybody's a fan of the airborne.
They are beautiful.
They go very well if you just want to do a nice dioramic piece. Although there are rules in some systems for tank riders.
Jerry, I've got to say, right? I think this might be the coolest thing in the world. Because I thought the Fallschirmjäger were flipping cool. Like, they were hard-ass. Like, really, really cool as units go. Never mind German units, right? Yeah. And then I've always thought that tank riders are the meanest-ass mother in the world, right?
Mm-hmm.
And now we have Fallschirmjäger tank riders.
It's one way of looking at it.
I don't know if you can get any better than that.
They are a very inviting target to machine gun fire, I will say that. Because you don't have to worry about heading
Bounces off
the trees. You know, that's difficult to hit, but a bunch of Fallschirmjägers on top of a tank, tank's a fairly inviting target, which is kind of why most countries stopped doing it. Russia, on the other hand, had a lot of tanks and a lot of tank riders, so they stuck with it. But they're a beautiful set of sculpts. If you're clever, you might be able to come up with some way of either magnetizing or having these as cell. If you don't want them on there all the time, because depending on the system you're playing, you might want Fallschirmjäger straddling your Tiger, might not.
Easy peasy magnification options here, right? So you get lovely little tiny neodymiums, okay?
Into their bottoms.
Into their butts, and then the opposite neodymium into the tank, obviously, before you paint the tank.
Yeah.
I don't even think you would need the neodymium inside the tank. Just a couple of big, heavy steel washers may do it, because there's enough pull. That's only a plastic tank for most companies, and they'll go right through there.
There, he's got tiny little neodymiums there, right? No, but the reason you would do the neodymiums, Jerry, is because I would actually just pin vise in to the top of the tank, then just pop the neodymium in, smooth it over, right? Uh-huh. So you've got all your points, and the two neodymiums will give you extra grip, okay? And you guys will just pop them on, then you just go, and then when you're ready, you just whip them off. Oh, that's so cool.
You gotta watch out for scorage, though, as their arses are being scraped on and off.
Yeah, but if it scrapes
heavy gloss paint.
It's metal. It's metal underneath, so I'm not gonna worry. Metal scraping on the tank. Tanks are made of metal. So
one way of looking at it, I would just go with steel or something inside, because then I don't have to find the relevant point anywhere on it. Will do the job.
Steel is inside where?
In the tank. Is it a plastic tank? It looked like a hunk of resin to me.
It depends where you buy your tank from.
But it's going to have to be very strong magnets to get through the plastic down to the steel. Like, these aren't going to cut it.
They should do. It depends on the pull of your magnet. You can get different strengths. But I use magnets and steel and stuff for movement trays, and some of them are maybe 2 to 3 mil of plastic between your contact points. So you just need to pick the right tool for the right job.
So you've got stronger magnets that can pull harder than mine.
Yeah.
Because mine don't have much of a pull at all.
Of course.
Even just in a big batch.
If you start Googling neodymium magnets, you'll discover that they are ranked based on pull between them. So I think even Green Stuff World, we have two different strengths. So there's like an N35 and N52.
Now's a great time. Did you know that On Tabletop have a store? Like, browse to store.ontabletop.com, because we can actually teach you something, and our amazing community. Buy merch from store.ontabletop.com today. Right. So on store.ontabletop.com, click on, do you see in the top categories? Click on Green Stuff World. No, they're down. It's down where the top categories are.
When he says top categories, he means the left-hand sidebar.
Oh, right, okay.
Yes, so there. So it's just a quick way to get through to Green Stuff World. Now, scroll down, Okay, and we have all these lovely filters. Keep going, because you'll see something about magnets very shortly. Okay. You'll see magnet grade. Okay. Mm-hmm. So N35 and N52. 52s are stronger than 35s. Okay. And then if you click on the 52, you can then go by diameter and by depth.
Oh, very nice.
To actually whittle it down to whatever specific size you're getting. And we're gradually building out more and more stock. And the fact that they all say add to cart means they are probably in stock.
Wow. So, disclaimer, not guaranteed.
No. If it says add to cart, it means it's 95% in stock.
Oh, look, there's definitely two in stock here, look.
There. And to top it all off, guys, we have a big Green Stuff World order has landed on our shores from Spain. So we've got a restock of all that Green Stuff World. So if you're into your Green Stuff World or you're into your Flames of War, we're a great place to go.
That's very disappointing to hear you say that. Because I discovered that they do acrylic the other day in like 1.6 mil fluorescent acrylics that I was going to get you to start stocking so I could do lightsabers.
Oh, well, we will say to Tom, who's
next time,
king dude behind all that, and we will get it. You know, it's I love the Green Stuff World. I like to sit and browse this just for ideas on weird or interesting stuff that we can do. You know, it's I just love some of the wacky concepts they come up with for hobbying. So anyway,
the teabag sandbags are particularly good.
Yeah, so if it says read more, it means that we're currently out of stock for it. Because as part of our commitment to, being as, as straight up with you guys as we can, whenever COVID-19 lockdowns happened and a lot of the manufacturers we deal with started shutting down, we made the decision to turn off all ability to back order. So we only sold what we have on our stock shelves and stored in the facility.
Yeah, and that was for all our ranges.
All ranges. We basically just went all ranges, turn off all ability to back order, because we want to make sure, especially during this, that that if you buy something, that we can get it out the door to you to keep you in your hobby heaven, at least. Because there'd be nothing worse than you punting down a lot of money and then having to wait weeks for an order to ship because one or more bits of it are still not being manufactured. So yes, if you're browsing around the store and you see a lot of stuff that's out of stock, it's temporary, but it's part of our commitment to making sure that you get the best service that we can kind of provide. Buy merch on Tabletop Store at store.ontabletop.com. Okay, right, so where were we?
Speaking of German motorbikes and sidecars, The other offensive miniature release, apart from the full shimulator, is a dinky little set there. So if you want to do donuts around your opponent with a bit of heavy support in a medium machine gun on that sidecar, then you can do this thing.
Indiana Jones enemies right there, man.
Mm-hmm. Yes, well.
That's Last Crusade kind of stuff there. Love it.
They certainly didn't seem to put up much of a problem for him, mind you. But it's nice to see, because occasionally you do see some miniatures like that, like Cradshutes and platoons and things like that. So it's nice to see the sort of fringe things that don't get a huge amount of look coming up.
Do you know what else is great about the Tank Rider set?
Yes.
Is it gives you a great set of miniatures that you can just literally sit around in, like camps and stuff, just sitting.
Yeah.
So you get some real diorama type options, not just sitting them on a tank.
Yeah.
Well, I think that one at the front is probably a bit more camp than the rest.
Totally.
Well, I like him.
Totally.
Interesting. He knows exactly what he's doing.
He does.
Tank riders, they used to actually train with their tank crews. They're going, you're going to be on this tank. There's the tank crew who drives this tank. Go and talk to them. Make sure that you know what happens whenever they're going to do this, so you don't get crushed by a rotating turret or whatever happens to them. Yeah.
It must have been terrifying to be riding on the back of one of them.
You know, Otto Carius managed to trap his foot in a rotating Tiger tank turret at one point.
Oh. Yeah. So, did he walk away from that? Did he lose the foot?
No, he kept the foot. Kept going.
But anyway, it's also rolling cover, so that's always a bonus, I guess. So.
It is if you're behind it. If
yeah, true.
They do just tend to hose you down with machine guns. That's why they don't do it these days.
I think it'd be very scary because, like, it's not like you see a lot of handles or harnesses and things for them to hold on to. Literally just sitting there. Like a few months ago, I tried riding a bike again after about 20 years. And you know the way they say you never forget how to ride a bike?
Yeah, you do.
That's not bloody true. I was all over the place. It was so scary.
What you need, Lloyd, is a well-positioned strap.
That's
right?
So someone needs to strap me on my bike.
You'd be on the tank with your strap on, right? And you waving it around in front of everybody, and nobody will want to mess with you, man.
That's very true. You were desperately trying to avoid that.
Nobody be coming anywhere near me, for sure.
Have we any more Germans, Jerry?
We do. Sticking with the country, but dropping back a war. War Games Atlantic have shown off essentially the box art and some of the painted miniatures for their World War I plastic German set, which is looking very nice.
That is nice, isn't it?
I think it's the first time we've seen a World War I faction for anything in plastic.
So pretty much,
28 mil. It's a good time to be coming because things like Blood and Valor.
Yes.
So 28 mil World War I skirmishes just come out. Because you need them. You've got your very, very early war pickle hull. So you've got the lovely spikes. And then obviously in short order, they changed to the style helm that we're more used to.
The Cybermen ones, with the little bolts on them.
Mm-hmm. They have little bolts because sometimes you need to screw trench armor onto that so that snipers don't shoot you through the head, because apparently those helmets aren't quite as heavily armored as you would imagine. So you've got the option to put another sheet of, you know, 2 or 3 centimeter steel on front of you.
The gas masks.
Yeah, the gas masks are very nice as well.
Yo, that's an Imperial Guard army waiting to happen right there, isn't it?
Well, there it is in the spree right there.
With the likes of, and if you look on the far left, you'll see that there's actually a row of 6 heads there. Oh, yeah. So I'm assuming
there we go.
When they've done any of these kits, when they've done their Raum Jaeger and the Le Grognards for Death Fields, they've always given a ton of heads, and there's always enough heads to do all of the same head if you want, because there's nothing more infuriating than getting a box and going, I'd really like to do everybody in kepis, and then discovering there's 3 kepis per sprue, and that means you can do half of the box. So they went, no, we're not doing that. Likewise with this, if you want to do them all in the same helmet type, all in gas masks, none with gas masks, the variety's in there, so they can all be done that way, along with the variety of weaponry as well, so you can tool out your World War I Germans for the trenches or other parts. You know.
The thing that I thought was kind of interesting about that set as well is that it kind of got into the wheelhouse that War Games Atlantic has done in the past with a lot of their other kits, where it's for a familiar period but a slightly different take on it. Because a lot of the time you see people doing things for World War One, which is a lot more in that early period when you've got that kind of that transition over from that older style of warfare into the trench warfare, that kind of thing. Whereas this is gone for that late war period, which traditionally you normally equate that phrase with World War Two, wouldn't you? But you know, it's gone for, as you say, that transition of helmets and style of, you know, uniform and armor and weapons into slightly more something a little bit more. That sort of feels like World War II, which is kind of cool. So you can see that nice sort of step in history between the two sets of armor and weapons and stuff.
And because you've got those options, you can do, you know, you can do 1914 or you can do 1918 or anywhere in between if you want, which is very handy. It's likewise going back to Blood and Valor. A lot of people have looked at Blood and Valor growing up, but why are you only doing late war? Because, you know, it's very dull, blah, blah, blah. Because they've seen the previews for a lot of Blood and Valor stuff, we've got the late war Germans and late war Americans and that sort of thing coming out first. They assume that period, that rule set, was only for the last couple of years of the war, and it's not. Yeah. It covers the entire span of the war. Likewise, this box set will do any period or any year within that, which is ideal, really.
Yeah. Right. This week, my musical choice has been Waylon Jennings. I have been yee-hawing and yippee-hi-yay all week. Okay. I'm really digging my country this week. And now, the Magnificent from Knuckle Duster previews are on the way. The Magnificent Seven, Ben.
Yeah, so this is a bunch of stuff from the guys at Knuckle Duster Miniatures. They have a game called Gunfighter's Ball, which is a really fun, quick and easy, awesome skirmish game that they've done set in the Wild West. And a lot of the miniatures they do are based on either historical people from the period or a lot of the iconic films and stuff that we've watched that sort of, you know, around the period. So, you know, spaghetti westerns and that kind of thing. So this is actually a set of renders that they've been putting out and previewing for the Magnificent Seven, as you might imagine, on the tabletop. So they've done quite a few of these already. They have done seven, but this week sort of saw them looking at maybe, I think it was three of them that they've been working on recently. And it shows a really nice selection of good, fantastically detailed characters and that kind of thing. One of the things I really like about what Knuckle Duster's miniatures do with their Wild West stuff is that they take a lot of things that you know from the films, for example, and then they'll add lots of historical sort of elements to them. So they'll try and make them as realistic as possible, even if they might be from like a Hollywood film and stuff as well, which I think is really nice. And they do the same with their, so their historical stuff.
Historical documents and make them more historical.
Yes, exactly. Yes. Yeah.
Why do I recognize some of these guys? Who is this? Is this?
I can't remember their names.
You know the way in the Magnificent Seven, there are characters played by people you know. So there's Yul Brynner's character, there's Robert Vaughn's character, there's Steve McQueen's character, and then there are other people. Charles Bronson, and then there are other people who are there, but you may not know.
Are they some of the seven?
Yeah. These are not those people.
These are the people that are not so famous.
As far as I'm aware,
I'm going to go out and let them say they were famous at the time, but not as famous as those other actors. He's my favorite actor ever. He was in all of the best.
But as I say, they have gone and done all of them now. Yeah. I think over Facebook, they've been sharing a lot of the different previews and all the kind of things for that. But it's just really nice to see them doing some really interesting and different stuff when it comes to, you know, their Wild West range. Like before this, they did a selection of sort of civilians that you can use in your games, because it's always nice to have something like scenario-based stuff in there.
Is this them? Is this the original?
That is the Magnificent Seven.
That is.
Hang
on, that looks weird.
Or is that? That's not right, is it?
No, that's not right.
Someone done some weird photoshopping on that?
They have. I'm not sure what's going on there.
I couldn't tell because my screen was small. But. Okay. But
doesn't look like the original.
But yeah, some really neat little new models they've been doing for the Magnificent Seven and stuff that you can use in your games. And as I was saying, they've done stuff before for like civilians. They did a lot of sort of Native American stuff as well. So they've done a lot of plainsmen and that kind of thing too. Yeah. So they've tried to cross the entire sort of gambit of stuff that they've done for Wild West.
Well, there's big names in there, like Steve McQueen, as you say, Charles Bronson.
Is this them?
Robert Vaughn, who you know from John Boy in Space.
Yes.
So it's
He's also James the man Coburn. From Uncle.
Yes, the man from Uncle.
Yes.
I wonder what these guys consider doing Elvis Presley from Flaming Star. Elvis did some amazing westerns.
If you've not seen their catalogue of stuff, if you've seen the film Tombstone, the good Wyatt Earp movie, not like Wyatt Earp.
Mm-hmm.
They have characters based on Michael Behan as Johnny Ringo and people like that. They've done the Young Guns with...
This weekend.
Estevez and his brother and Sutherland. They're all in there.
I've been telling the missus all about how Ben looks like Emilio Estevez.
Well, Ben does have a sheen about him. He does have a sheen look. He certainly does.
I don't know what that tells me about my lifestyle, but...
It's the tiger blood, man. You've got the tiger blood.
You sure remember you had that photo of you? You standing.
Yeah, we managed to trick Sam. Family. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Right. What's next? I think we've one more news story, Ben, yeah?
Yeah. So we've got one more news story. It's another bit of free for the coronavirus period kind of thing. Mm-hmm. And that is that Fantasy Flight Games have a game called Keyforge, which is a really quick and easy card game to dive into. You just need a deck of cards. They're all unique. You play the game with some very, very simple mechanics. really nice, quick and simple to play. You can play it with families, kids, anybody can play it basically. And so the people at FFG decided, you know what we'll do? We'll put four decks out for free for you to go and download and print off and use at home. So there are four complete decks for you to go and print off and use at home. They've also done the PDFs for the rules, which already exist on their website. And they've also done the PDFs for the tokens as well. So you've got everything you need to play Keyforge. And then if that takes your fancy, because why would it not? You can play it for free, give it a go. You can then go and, you know, dive into Keyforge yourself and play it as well. So nice. Yeah, some really cool stuff there.
Very nice. Just
right.
A quick look for the tokens. But carry on.
Yeah, I'm sure they're in there. Right. Next up, Kickstarters. Okay. So we have three Kickstarters this week that we're keeping an eye on. Kicking off with the Defence Of Procyon III. I think it's Procyon and not Procyon. I'm not sure. But the Defence Of Procyon III, 17 days left, PSC Games. Who wants to give us a rundown on it?
Hello, everybody, and welcome. I am joined in the studio today by David Turksi. Have I got
Turksi.
It right?
Close enough.
And today we are going to be talking about the Defence Of Procyon III from PSC Games. So, David, welcome to the show, buddy.
Good to be here.
So, this is a game that you have developed for 1 to 4 players, yeah?
Yes, the original concept was for 4 players only. Mm-hmm. And because it's a 2v2 team game, mm-hmm. where one player of each side takes charge of the space or the ground battle around this planet, that and one team is the human defenders, one team is the alien invaders trying to shut down whatever archaeological dig the humans are doing, because they are unearthing an ancient artifact belonging to another race that the our aliens don't want to be found. And and it started out as a 4-player asymmetric team, mm-hmm. Euro combat game kinda, mm-hmm. and then after adding a lot of interconnections between the boards, I was like, okay, but now what do I do with less than 4 players? Mm-hmm. So for 3 players, somebody has to play both sides of one team, which is a bit of a brain burner, but I've seen people do it. For 2 player, you can either both double play one side and play 1v1, or I've developed with the wonderful help of my lovely girlfriend, who'll probably pop in by the camera later accidentally, and an automa, a solo bot essentially, that takes charge of one of the sides, mm-hmm. and then you alone or with a friend of yours, so 1 or 2 players can play against the automa and have the full experience of tactical shooting. Mm-hmm. So that's how the 1 and 4 player comes together, yes.
Mm-hmm. Now, I actually did have the good fortune to actually receive a demo copy of this.
Very few of those.
Yeah, I've had it in my hands. I've been having a look at some of the miniatures and the layouts of stuff of the board and some of the tokens and things, and it looks really, really good. One of the things that really jumped out at me is the asymmetric nature of each of the factions, because each of the 4 plays incredibly different to each other.
Yes, it's like when I say asymmetric war game for Euro players, then what everybody's mind jumps to is Root, right? Mm-hmm. Because it's a really good game, it's been really successful, and it's fairly asymmetrical. Mm-hmm. Procyon is several factors more asymmetric, mm-hmm. than Root is. Root fundamentally uses the same turn structure, the same concepts for every faction, and then has custom strategy requirements and custom planning requirements for each of them, mm-hmm. and some special abilities and whatnot. Procyon is essentially 4 individually not too complicated card games, mm-hmm. and the output of each card game is move your units on the board and shoot with them. Mm-hmm. So the problem that most very asymmetric games, I'm thinking of Vast here, or yeah, I'm not gonna remember the rest, is that in order to make sensible choices yourself, you have to understand your inner workings and everybody else's inner workings as well. Mm-hmm. And that's why Root is not as asymmetric as it could be, because they made it good instead of asymmetric. Mm-hmm. So my problem was, how can I keep it both good and asymmetric? Mm-hmm. And the solution is that because the game is purely about moving troops around and shooting, there is no area control element, there is no engine building element, there are combos you have to prepare, there are resources you have to manage, mm-hmm. but the rough amount of damage and mobility you can do on a turn is fairly stable, mm-hmm. and assuming you might get unlucky a little bit on one turn, but well, luck is not the right word because it's card draws, but you go through your whole deck. So mm-hmm. sometimes it comes even spread, sometimes it's a bit front loaded, sometimes it's a bit back loaded. But all you need to know is what's the biggest damage your opponent can do to you. Mm-hmm. So the game comes with four rule books, one for each faction. Each rule book is like 10 pages long with examples and the player aid on the back. So don't imagine like a game with a binder. So yeah,
you're not picking up an ancient tome.
No. And each rule book teaches every single rule about your faction, mm-hmm. about 15% of your teammate, and about 25% of your opponent. Mm-hmm. And now, that's all you need to know to make strategic moves. And sometimes it'll go, oh, how did you do that? And then, but in battle, you don't come with a utility sheet of what your opponent can do. So yeah. A little bit of unexpected moves is fine in my opinion.
You have a little bit of fog of war.
Yes, yes. So basically, you not having perfect information about everything is essentially part of fog of war. But if you play the game 4, 5, 6 times, then you become the experienced general who can anticipate the opponent's moves. And again, I'm fine with that too, as long as somebody's first game is just as fun as somebody's sixth game. Mm-hmm. Their strategies might be different, but the amount of fun needs to be present from the first game onwards.
Well, it's one thing that comes across really cleanly is the contextual idea of what each faction is trying to do, which blends into those mechanics. So if you're playing the alien fleet, you're trying to set up a blockade to actually stop the human defenders gaining reinforcements. I also love the fact that between the space battle and the ground battle, each of the two boards really affects how your teammate can play the game.
Yes, and I always wanted that, and like I've been working on the game for a year at that point, and it's like all of them were working fairly fine, but there was always one faction that took a little bit longer to resolve mm-hmm. than the rest. And whenever that person's team was on, everybody else was bored. Mm-hmm. I was like, why? It's because there is no cross-consent. So I spent the second year of development mm-hmm. making sure that everything has a reason not just to shoot your opponent, mm-hmm. but to set up strategies and to hurry your teammate. Mm-hmm. So with the humans, it's more obvious because they have shared resources, the echo drones that they both want to spend and they can both generate, but they both want the other to generate it because they have more urgent things to do, mm-hmm. but they're in it together, so they do have to help each other. While with the aliens, it's more like, do I set up such a big blockade that the armada can't help the humans on the ground, but then I can't help my ground, or do I help them more, etc., mm-hmm. etc. Even the ground aliens have cards that can shoot up into space, but by doing that, you're not hurting your ground enemy. So mm-hmm. it's now all trade-offs and choices. And because each deck in the game is tiny, the alien space force has a deck of 8 cards. Mm-hmm. That's the smallest, and the human space has a deck of 22, I think, or 23, and that's the biggest. Mm-hmm. So every other deck is between 8 and 23 cards, and the game is 10 turns long, and you play 2 to 4 cards per turn, depending on which faction you're playing with, which means you see every card, every game in different order. Mm-hmm. And that, to me, reminds me of Quartermaster General in a way, but Quartermaster General is a very micro game. It's a series of I love it, don't get me wrong, I absolutely love it, but any one of your moves in Quartermaster is rarely big. It's usually a sequence of 4 quick turns that I finally achieved what I wanted, mm-hmm. whereas in Procyon I wanted everything to be big yet not super complicated. Yeah. So on the very first turn, alien ground force starts the game, plays 3 cards. Probably 3 human units are already dead.
Yeah.
Out of their 15 starting units.
Yeah, well, you're expecting an opening salvo to the battle. And yes, with the card mechanics that you've designed, you're able to keep a very low randomness factor to this game, where it's,
yes,
it's all about your strategic choices.
Only real randomness in the game is the alien ground. When they attack, they pull cubes from a bag, mm-hmm, and the more units they attack with, the more cubes they pull, and then black cubes hit, white cubes miss. Mm-hmm. But it's a back-building game, so if you pull all white, it removes a white. If you pull more than one black, it removes a black. Oh. And the aliens have abilities to add black to the bag, and the humans have abilities to add white to the bag.
Ah, I see.
So so at that point, I've seen somebody go like, okay, I'm going to attack twice this turn, and then I'm going to attack three times next turn, and then on those five pulls, they deal 10 damage, which is insane. Mm-hmm. But then they've lost five black cubes from their bag at least.
Yeah, well, it's all about that curve where things are going to rebalance, exactly, out. You know, it's something I love about, you know, cube mechanics within games. Whenever you're drawing a blind resource from a bag, eventually the other side of it has to come out somewhere.
And the Armada has a different mechanism, which I really love, is that they have a deck of cards exactly as big to draw every single card in the game, or like plus minus one card, and they draw six cards at the beginning of the game. Mm-hmm. Three of them go into their hand. Three of them go into their combat deck. Mm-hmm. And every time they attack, they flip the top card of the combat deck, and that's how many damage they deal. Mm-hmm. And obviously, the good cards have lots of hits on them, and the bad cards have few hits on them. Mm-hmm. So when you draw an amazing starting hand, then yes, sure, all your hits will hit and all your starting moves will be amazing, but your forces aren't yet in position. Mm-hmm. Whereas if you draw a terrible starting hand, then you barely want to shoot anything at the beginning of the game, but you can hold back your least bad cards to get into position, and then when three rounds into the game you get six more cards, three of which will get shuffled into your combat deck, three of which will be added to your hand, then suddenly you experience a jump in power. Mm-hmm. And if you draw a half good, half bad hand, then do you keep the good cards and put the bad cards into the combat deck, therefore forever polluting your combat chances? Or do you keep the bad cards, use it to set up, put the good cards into the combat deck to start off well, and then later on when you draw more good cards, that's when you start hitting. Mm-hmm. So again, this is a kind of randomness, but the way randomness can affect you is entirely your choice and your strategy. Mm-hmm. And there is no such thing as, oh my god, I drew the worst card, I've lost. So yeah, to the point where I've seen experienced players not even flip the cards from their combat deck. They were just like, okay, so there are four cards left in my combat deck. That means over the next four attacks, I deal a total of six damage. Here is four attacks. So that's not randomness.
Mm-hmm. Well, it's tactical choice at that point. So there is randomness there, but it's down to you. How do you build into it?
Yes,
it's controlled randomness. Yes.
Exactly, and there's dice in the alien space fleet, but that's rolled at the beginning of the game, and then you spend those dice for action points.
Ah, I see.
So it's not you do something and then roll a dice and see if it hits on that. And the fourth faction, the alien, the human ground troops, they literally have no randomness. You say, I have four action points this turn, so those four units will damage you once each. Mm-hmm. So there the randomness comes from the fact that you have 18 cards in a deck destruction game. Every turn you lose one card from your deck, mm-hmm, and you use its special ability, but obviously the cards with better special abilities have more actions on them. So if you use the good special abilities early, the total number of actions in your deck decreases. Mm-hmm. So there the only sort of randomness is what order do you draw your cards in, and different cards let you move different units. So can you move the unit you want to? Mm-hmm. But once you know, see that these are your hands and this is how many actions you have and these are the heroes you can move, then there is no more randomness. Then you distribute, these two will attack, these two will evacuate civilians, and that one will build a barricade. So again, it's cooking with options. It's not hoping for the best. There is no hope for the best anywhere in the game.
Yeah, and your fate is what you make in this game from what I'm hearing, because if I make bad tactical choices, the later game is going to become more and more difficult for me because I've made bad tactical choices, and that will teach me to play better tactically.
Exactly, and you say tactical, but I say any choice that affects one third of the game is not tactical, it's strategic. Sometimes you don't attack on purpose because the strategic consideration is more important than the tactical, and that's why the game is, it takes about 2 hours to play, but at most 10 turns. You take 10 card plays, one card play being 2 to 4 or 3 cards, but that means that if you set up a 3-turn combo to blow up one of the opponent's big ships, that was your strategy.
Mm-hmm.
That was one third or half of the game potentially.
Yeah.
And that's why there's an objective system, and the humans start higher than the aliens, but they can lose points very easily. Mm-hmm. Whereas the aliens have trouble starting to score points, but when they break through, they go like point.
Mm-hmm.
And then if anybody reaches 42 points, then whoever has more points at the end of the round wins. And if nobody reaches that, then whoever has more points at the end of the 10th round wins. So, and like blowing up a human capital ship is 9 points. So that alone is 1/4 of the game. And if the human is not playing protectively of their capital ship, it takes about 1.5, maybe 2.5 turns to blow one up.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Well, I mean, like, it's...
Everything matters.
Yeah, everything, of course, matters, because you have limited resources within this war, because, you know, you're not right next to Earth. They're not sending you fresh capital ships every other week. You have what you have.
And for anybody who's played War of the Ring, the concept is familiar. If the bad guys lose a ship, they get it back in their supply. If the good guy loses a ship, it's dead.
Aye.
So...
Now, one of the things I was looking at whenever I was having a look through the contents of the game is, in the alien ground forces side, there seems to be one character, and on the human side, I think it's 4 characters?
Yes, so the aliens, basically the way these aliens work is they have a few females, they are the million kids, and the males are just there to be the muscle.
Mm-hmm.
And so all your ground soldiers are the called the Legion. Mm-hmm. They are the freshly spawned little alien critters. And then you have three to five. The names of the aliens are what the humans named them, because we can't pronounce their actual name. So then you have 3 to 5 centurions, which are the big tough units that aren't very strong but very hard to kill.
Mm-hmm.
And then you have the one empress, the scary looking alien lady. Mm-hmm. Like 3 or 4 out of the 20 cards they have is like, do something horrible to whoever is sharing a location with the Empress. So you really don't want to be near her. But the Empress is actually easier to kill than a Centurion, and if you do, you get 10 points, which is, again, 1/4 of the game.
Yep.
And it can be killed in 2 turns or less if they're not playing protectively.
Mm-hmm.
So... And if you get the Empress to the center of the board, to the human city, you score 5 points per turn.
Oh, that's... nasty.
So if you can get the Empress to the center of the board and keep it alive for at least 2 turns, you're probably winning
the game.
Quarter
of the way to the victory, yeah.
Exactly. So, but if you just rush ahead with a small army with the Empress leading it, then the Empress will get killed. There, boom.
Yeah. Well, I mean, like, someone's going to look at it and go, I don't like that. That has to die right now.
So, to me, this moment when I finished all the balancing and I was like, yeah, I can have a nice play with any faction. And then I told the game to my girlfriend, who's famous for being able to beat me at literally every game, always.
Everybody has that one person.
And she played Meld, the space aliens.
Mm-hmm.
I went, I can blow up the space refinery in 3 turns no matter what you do. I'm like, oh my god, the game is broken. No, I can do whatever I want in 3 turns, whatever you do. It's like, okay, but then how does the Armada win? It doesn't matter, I can do whatever I want with the Armada in 3 turns as well. So I thought that this would be a rock, paper, scissor of tactical combat, and instead it turned out that my actual stated objective of have a strategy and execute it is even more important, because any strategy can be made viable if you play it well.
Yep, definitely. And if your opponent doesn't know what strategy you're playing to,
then they don't know how to counter it. Help them achieve their strategy exactly. by walking into it. Exactly.
Or so. You're not countering their moves.
Exactly. So, and countering is a very tactical thing, but if you spend too much effort tactically countering, then you lose. Like newbie players tend to understand the ground aliens fastest because here are three cards, play one, do it. Mm-hmm. But it's very easy to make tactical moves with them. You pull in an army, you deal three damage, boom, good job.
Yeah.
But if you do it once here, once here, once here, you damage every human defender a little bit, mm-hmm. then the human defender gets their act together and just kills one of your groups. Then you're like, okay, where did my firepower go?
Yeah, so, it's the old thing of he who attacks everywhere attacks nowhere.
Exactly. So whereas if you had a strategy and said, I'm going to push everything onto this one pylon, focus, and when they're barely defended, that's when I'm going to kill their heroes on the other side of the board. Mm-hmm. That works. And of course, for the space players, it's always a question of how much effort do I spend bombarding, dropping reinforcements versus how much effort do I'm spending on killing my opponent.
Mm-hmm. Yeah,
because... and the little points, the easy scores are all on the space board, but the big scores are all on the ground board.
Yeah, yeah, but everybody's earning at that point, and it's deciding where is the most value to do that earning for the victory points.
And the coolest stuff we haven't talked about is the thematic jail, is that the humans have a research outpost on the planet, mm-hmm. and they're trying to evacuate the scientists and their families. And the scientist is a unit on the ground board that can only be killed if there is nothing else there, so because everybody's protecting them.
Yep.
But if 7 or 8 scientists die, the humans immediately lose the game.
Mm.
And if a scientist gets close to the center of the board, to the spaceport,
mm-hmm.
then you can spend the equator on the shared resource to launch them into space. Sounds and then you flip it to the other side and you get this transport ship, completely defenseless, on the middle of the spaceboard, and you have to get out to the edge of the spaceboard to escape.
Oh, again, that could be so interesting, because if you've been able to push the aliens back far enough, it's just like, okay, let's launch some scientists, let's get out of here. And then all of a sudden, the aliens in space are looking at it going, well, there's some easy points, let's shoot that. No, to hell with you, human capital ship, I have this to shoot.
And on any turn where you launch a scientist to space, the human space force gets an extra move, but one fewer attack, because they have to mobilize to protect.
Yeah.
And if they don't mobilize to protect, like if they leave the escaping transport in suborbit, then mm-hmm. it burns up in the atmosphere.
Ah, okay.
So it's not like... at the end of the game, I'll launch all my scientists into space and we'll score some points on it, because when you launch a scientist into space, the space player has to react to it immediately mm-hmm. on the very next turn. Otherwise, that scientist is kaput.
Mm-hmm.
So pressure points everywhere. And when I talk about these strategies and pressure points, I'm thinking like I'm designing a Euro game, right?
Mm-hmm.
Like pick any Euro game you love, and I don't know, I'm looking at the box of brass here, so that's the first game that's going to pop into my mind. You have strategies, so it's like, okay, do I want to max out the manufactured goods, or do I want to develop up the track of cotton first, and ooh, what if he builds more iron mine than I can develop cheaper, or should I build coal, and you know, mm-hmm. it's strategies and trade-offs.
Mm-hmm.
Whereas when you play war games, it's about maneuvers and feints and I was like, why not both?
Yeah, this sounds absolutely fantastic to me. I mean, like it's that trade-off of fire output versus, you know, your resource management to actually complete your objectives. It's something I look at a lot of times when I'm playing like a regular war game. Like, say I'm sitting down to play a game of 40K with a friend. It's, okay, how much fire output do I have? Okay, great. I have lots of fire output, but I don't have anything that's going to complete my game objectives during the game. I need to fix that.
And I combined this trade-off with a Euro card game.
Mm-hmm.
With a... how do I deck destruct? How do I split my risk mitigation? How do I play with my back building? These are fundamentally Euro concepts mm-hmm. in a game about moving units and shooting. So with beautiful cards, with thematic text. So mm-hmm. it's like I tried to take what I like most about Ameritrash games, what I like most about war games, and what I like most about Euro games, and say, I want it all. So this game is, to me, the no compromise game.
Mm-hmm. It definitely sounds like it. Now,
yet most no compromise games tend to be 4-hour monsters with 60-page rule books. Mm. And yet, once, if you don't want to read, well, if you read all rule books together, it's still 57 pages, but you only need to read 10 of that to play the game.
Yeah, well, I mean, it sounds like a fabulous, fun game. It sounds like people are going to be able to dive in, and whenever people are learning the game, trading out to different factions is going to give people such a different game experience. I think it's going to keep them coming back for more and more.
That's what I'm hoping. Normally, after the first game, everybody says, oh my god, my job was so hard, I want to play the other side. And then the other side says, yeah, exactly. So there are the kind of people who want to keep playing the same side to get better at it, and there are some people who can't understand how the opponent didn't win bigger, so they want to play the opponent.
Yeah.
And then they realize that it's just as hard for them. So that alone, you know, squares the replayability of the game. Mm-hmm. Plus, as I said, the fact that whether the first six cards you draw are all strong, all weak, or half strong, half weak, makes you adapt to completely different strategies. So, you know,
yeah,
you learn, you adapt, and then you kick some alien behind.
Yeah, definitely. Well, David, it sounds like an absolutely fabulous game. Is there anything else you would like to make sure and let people know about for the game? Or have we covered it?
Anybody who's played any of my solo modes should know to trust me on this. So if you're worried that you can't get four people together to play this, then still come and check it out, because mm-hmm. we've got something for you as well. There will be a small expansion, which is like swapping bonus units for each faction with a few extra minis. I don't know how much it's going to cost and exactly how many pieces going to be in it. So come check it out on the Kickstarter page. Mm-hmm. Defence of Procyon III coming on Kickstarter April 21st. And while you're waiting for that, don't forget to check out my other game also on Kickstarter right now, Excavation Earth, from a different publisher, but it's completely different, although it has aliens as well, but it's a market manipulation, dual-use card game drafting set collection game about aliens digging up artifacts on Earth after humanity has gone extinct, and selling it to the highest bidder on the galactic art dealer market.
Awesome. Well, David, thank you very much for joining us. Everybody, get your comments in below if you have queries, questions, thoughts about this game. I'm sure David will probably be keeping an eye on the comments. We'll move on here.
I'm everywhere.
Well, we'll see you again soon.
So as well as, obviously, the sci-fi worlds of Procyon 3 and what they're doing with that Kickstarter, which we just had an interview about there, which is very cool indeed. It sounds very interesting as a game concept. I really like it, that kind of Euro wargamey kind of thing. Very, very cool.
Yeah.
We also have one from the folks at Printable Scenery, who we are very much in love with. They're very, very cool guys.
Yep.
And they have a new Kickstarter called Brave New Worlds.
Mm-hmm.
So this is another one of their big 3D printing STL file Kickstarters, where they are this time creating three different environments on the tabletop for you to play your games in. They have the one which is called New Eden, which mm-hmm. is very much a style of sort of like lost alien civilizations that have been stranded on a distant planet that you go and explore, very Star Trek kind of feel to it.
Love it.
You've also got the Waste World, which is like a post-apocalyptic style thing. Think zombie movies, think Mad Max, rust, metal, all that kind of thing. Downed UFOs, the blasted landscapes of Terminator, that kind of thing. And then they've also got Sanctuary 17, which is a set of terrain that could be used for, you know, if you wanted to try and remake The Thing on the tabletop, or if you wanted to build something like a moonscape sort of colonization style thing out in the depths of space as well, so get a little bit more corporate. So all the different terrain ranges they've done are completely 3D printable at home. They are packed with detail. You can get inside them and tinker around with them as well, as you can see in the videos that we've got there and stuff. Really, really nice stuff. And yeah, as I say, three different styles of environments you can go for. You could go for all of it if you really wanted to as well. But you you know, basically back each one, and you'll get a whole bunch of terrain to play around with at home. The other cool thing they've done on top of that is they've got a whole bunch of stretch goals, which we'll look at later as well, which are tied into each of the different environments. So whichever one you pledge for, you're going to get a whole bunch of cool stuff to tinker with on the tabletop.
And Jerry, in one fell swoop, they have sorted out our Star Wars terrain needs forever. I love that Aztec-y looking stuff is amazing. Yeah. Absolutely amazing. As well as that, I have my agnostic lizard man army, that I think are going to love that. Oh, that's so good.
Run 7TV Stargate figures through the middle.
Oh, yeah, absolutely. Yeah. I love the crashed plane in the
Wasteworld.
Really cool.
But the moon base as well. Check that.
The moon base is so cool. The immediate thing I thought about for that is for using it for some kind of like Infinity style thing. I think would be really cool doing something across like a moonscape or something. That'd be really nice.
I immediately thought Reichbusters / Wolfenstein.
Oh, Nazis, yeah. Like Nazis on the moon.
And the I immediately thought Space 1999.
Space 1999 is, it's very that or Captain Scarlet. It looks like the base that was destroyed at the start of Captain Scarlet when the Mistrons arrived.
Yeah. Do you know what, as a Nazi moon base, though, I think that would work really well.
The thing that I also thought would be really cool is that if anyone's seen the Amazon TV series The Expanse, they in one of the seasons they go to a new world, and there's that kind of like colonist style thing going on where a lot of the stuff has landed there, but then over time it's sort of aged and become decrepit. So it'd be really interesting to see what this kind of like more clean cut moon based style stuff would look like. It was a bit more grungy and stuff. So it would, as well as you being able to do the 3D printing side of thing and make them all a reality, you could then get in with some more traditional terrain making skills and try and, you know, dirty them up and add lots of tarpaulins and all that kind of thing over the top as well. That would be really cool.
Let's just quickly cycle through and see some of the kind of stretch goals and stuff that they've opened up. It's just what an amazing Kickstarter.
Looking at the components of the moon base. Yeah. So all of this has been built from these modular bits,
it's all
then,
modular,
is it?
Yep. The stretch goals are kind of cool. They've done some really nice. So one of the I was having a flick through it earlier when I was putting together a story for them as well. So they've done lots of really interesting sort of sci-fi bits for the temples. Like they've got that one there, you can see. Mm-hmm. They've also done which is like an ancient missile silo. So it's a big ruin from that alien planet that has like a big missile at the bottom of it, which is really cool. They've done the crashed UFO that you can see there as well. So that could be brought into the wasteland thing if you're going to try and do something a bit more like Fallout-y or something as well, which is really cool.
Mars Attacks.
Loads of really cool stuff that they've done for this. The craters as well. Everyone needs craters if you're going to do some kind of, you know, landscape that needs difficult terrain on it and stuff.
Jaws! Jaws!
There's the orca. You just put it on top of the mountain. Mm-hmm.
Destroyed by a radioactive megalodon, probably, in this world. Yeah.
So. Oh, man, look at them. Yeah. There's an alien sphincter! Awesome! Yeah.
And one of the things to note, obviously, is with all of those stretch goals, as I was saying earlier, they are tied to specific groups. So if you pledge for the wasteland stuff, you'll get everything else that will go with the wasteland pledge and stuff like that. So, but there's basically enough kind of stuff here for you to just pledge for one of those different, you know, styles of terrain, and you have effectively terrain that you will need forever for that kind of game. Basically,
look at the ravenous hunters.
They are very cool.
Feed me, Seamon! Feed me now! Oh, man!
Feed me, Seamon! Feed me all night long!
Oh!
So as well as the stuff that we can see here on the website, we actually we were sent a bunch of files by the guys at Printable Scenery.
Yes.
So we actually sat down and printed some off because Justin's in the studio still, so he was playing around with that. Mm-hmm. And you can see some of the results. And as you can see, all comes out very, very nicely indeed. One thing that was a big winner was the bus. I think John really liked how the bus had come out. Yeah. That was really cool. But yeah, some stunning looking 3D.
No, these will not be printed at the highest detail because Justin will wanted to wing these out. You had very limited time.
Well, no, it's not just that. It's just Justin used a really ropey camera as well. So a lot of what you're seeing there is pixelation rather than the final product. So
yeah, but even then, you can see that it's come out really nicely, and with a little bit of tidying up here and there, it would look really nice with, you know, base coat and a bit of paint on it. Perfect, really.
Mm-hmm. So.
I love this.
Bus. I wonder if the top comes off that bus.
Love that.
Well, we're going to get the bus now in a sec. Here we go.
Because you can see inside the bus. And I would say if the roof doesn't come off that bus, there's too much detail on that bus. Because you can see through the windows, you can see the seats. And
yes.
If you can't reach them to paint them.
Uh-huh.
I would just lose what little shit I have left.
It's fun to come in bits, otherwise you'd have a you'd have a point where the 3D printer would just fall through the roof. I would have thought.
I have no idea. I can't see where it splits because of the way there's wicker stuff over some of the windows and that, you know.
That's right. The thing that's good about this, obviously, is that it kind of shows you a little bit of a proof of concept of what they've done as well. So, like, whereas normally if you're potentially looking at some 3D printing stuff, you'd be like, what does it actually look like in real life? Well, there you go. We've printed it off and shown it. So
I've got something to say about printable scenery. The reason I am so deeply in love with these particular guys is, A, they design their stuff to print without needing supports. Because doing your supports on 3D printing, especially FDMs, can be a real pain in the arse. So their stuff normally works. It just works. It prints. Secondly, I have access to a few of their previous bits and pieces. And very regularly, you get update emails coming through where they've improved a 3D print, fixed an issue with the print or whatever, so they are constantly on it. So when you buy stuff from them and you're in their back end, they are updating constantly and improving upon stuff.
That's cool. They'll patch it if it needs to.
They patch it, yeah. And finally, they're just the most wonderfully creative team. I'm not going to sit here and say I love everything that they've done. Some of it's just not my cup of tea. But the bits that I have loved, I have really loved.
Quite recently, they did a sort of underground mushroom fungoid dungeon thing, and that was really cool. So, and of course, it had mushrooms in it, so Warren was away with the fairies for that one. So,
I'm telling you now, I must have printed, Jerry, would I have 100 of them mushrooms printed, maybe more?
You could fill a 6x4 with them.
I can't reach it because of COVID-19. Kept out of my way. But see, whenever I get out of this shit and I get back into that studio, I am going to be Mushroom Man. Because I have a Mushroom Man gaming table's worth of stuff ready to go.
Bye-bye YouTube distribution again.
So it's they're the most magic mushrooms I've ever seen, man. They are just awesome. You've got to be careful though, because if they're on the floor, you might trip over them. And anyway, I can't wait. Of that Kickstarter, my absolute favorite, the Aztec stuff. I am going to be all over that like a rash, like a dirty mushroom rash. That's how good that is. Love it. Oh, just look at it. Just look at it. Jerry, oh, man.
It does. It screams Masasi Sith Temple. I'm not going near it.
It does, actually. I didn't think about that. Yeah.
It's so cool. I just want it. I want it now. I want it now. I want this to be over so as I can be back in our studios smothering myself in coolness again. Oh, but I've got to say, printable scenery have managed to do it. This is the first full-on longing to get back into the studio I've had. Well done, printable scenery. I'm going to go and order filament and keep Justin busy. Oh, no, I can't, because the Kickstarter hasn't fulfilled. But hopefully it'll fulfill pretty quickly. Those guys are normally pretty good. They have a bunch of stuff rocking, ready to go, so... Oh, I want an Aztec table, Jerry. I want an Aztec table. Speaking of table, I am going a little bit loony bin here, sitting at home. So I've got stuff to talk in the XLBS show on Sunday, where how am I going to extract myself from this loony bin mentality that I've got myself in. I never realized that it was going to be as hard to be home as it is, because you think home is where the heart is. Home is where the pain in the arse is. And I look at you boys and just how organized you all are. Lloyd, you totally piss me off that. I am utterly, utterly scundered every time I'm looking at it.
Look at it. Absorb it.
So I'm going to talk about this.
I'll get out of the way of it.
Sunday. Piss off, Lloyd. Piss off, man. Right. Right. Do you know what?
Why? Hands up, who's got kids? I think we've solved it right there.
Right, we've one more little Kickstarter to show you guys. It's Ambush Epic by the guys at Dark Doors Entertainment. Before that, Brave New Worlds, 23 days left to go. If you're into your 3D printing, you don't need me to tell you that you're going to get in on that, because we are all going to get in on that. It's just awesome. Right. Ambush Epic, though, 12 days to go. It's a semi-cooperative dungeon-delving card-slash-board game, Ben.
Yeah. So this is, as you say, by the guys at Dark Doors Entertainment, and the sort of focus behind this game is that you're going to be playing a team of adventurers who are delving into dark and dank dungeons in order to claim glory, fame, gold, riches, everything you could ever want. However, the twist in the tale is that only one of you can be the one who is effectively in the bard's songs at the tavern at the end of the day. That doesn't mean you have to kill everyone else, but it means that you have to be the one that lands all the killing blows, comes out on top, gets the most glory, kills all the bonds, bosses, and that kind of thing as well.
So it's competitive then?
It's competitive, yeah. So the game plays out in a very, very simple fashion. You've got a deck of cards in the center, which will have all the different monsters and stuff in it, and then you'll have your player tableaus, your player boards around the outside as well. You'll start with a whole bunch of gear and a set of poly dice to sort of track the strength of your gear and how you're going to use it in the in-game. So it starts with from D4 and goes all the way up to like D12s, D20s, and that kind of thing as well, which is obviously the most epic kind of gear. Mm-hmm. What you'll do on your turn is you'll draw cards from the deck, and those cards can then either be kept in front of you so that you face the monster, or you can pass it to the left or to your right. There's also cards in there which will have you fighting against another player at the table, so you're trying to gain glory against one of the other heroes. Or one of my favorite cards in the deck is the popcorn card, and that is where you sit back and you let two other players fight each other to see who comes out on top, which is kind of cool. As I say, the game is kind of based around the idea of you killing monsters, getting fame and glory. And as you do, you'll unlock new cards and new abilities from the treasure deck, which you'll then slot into your tableau. So maybe upgrade your helmet and your armor, your weapons, your magic spells and all that kind of thing. The other sort of aspect of the game as well, apart from the trying to work out exactly what monsters you should face but then give to other players, is the sort of dice management aspect of the game as well. Because once you use dice on your cards and stuff, you need to decide how you're going to use them in the best way in order so you can get the most out of them. So if you use the dice for, you know, defeating a smaller enemy, you're not going to have them later on for defeating someone else until that sort of item comes back and that kind of thing as well. The artwork for the game looks really cool. I really like what they've done with that. It's got a really nice sort of like cartoony feel to it, nice and fun. It kind of helps soften the blow of it being that kind of backstabby style game, because you get a lot of games like that are a bit more serious, but I like the fact this one's got a little bit more of a sort of comic twist to everything, which I think is really good. Mm-hmm. Another key thing for games like this as well is that there is no player elimination. So you can't kill someone and then they sit back and be like, well, what the hell do I do kind of thing. Instead, if you get taken out by monsters or another player, a lot of your equipment resets, but you're just basically straight back into the fight again. So you can try and build back up, but you'll have lost a lot of the glory and the gold and the fame for doing so. So no player elimination, always a big plus. Semi-cooperative, that competitive sort of style of gameplay to it. Really nice artwork. Got poly dice in it. Any game with poly dice gets a thumbs up from me. Really awesome little dungeon delver that will be different every time you play it, because you'll have that nice deck of cards that will be shuffled up and come at you in different styles and stuff. So yeah,
this ticks a lot of boxes for me as a family man. Right, let me explain. I love the fact that this is a kind of like a dungeon delver, and I love it has the poly dice in it, because I love to get my kids to play with the poly dice and to feel the geometries and stuff like that. Okay, I think having poly dice connected in there is a lovely stepping stone. The artwork is superb for a sitting around with the family style game. And how do I put this? I'm not one of these daddies where everyone's a winner. Okay, I like my kids to learn how to lose so that they know how to win. Okay, I think, you know, learning how to lose is an important thing, because life is going to kick you in the balls a lot. And if they go through life and get more shit happening than we've had through our lives, they're going to get a lot of kicks in the balls. So they're going to have to learn how to deal with it.
So they'll be like standing there going, oh, this is crap. Ah, but don't worry. When I was 5, a big monster fly thing kicked me in the balls. So I'll be grand.
All the little lessons build up. It's all those little life lessons that toughen their skin and make sure that they can actually go out and not only deal with life, but hopefully be a somewhat of a positive influence on the world rather than one of these whiny bitches that is just sitting back waiting for everything to happen. This strikes me as a game which is a nice balance of not having my kids become whiny bitches. Because...
I made that on the box art then. Save your kids from being whiny bitches.
Yes.
So, this Kickstarter.
The fact is that nobody dies. That's a good thing, right? That is a good thing because...
It means you can keep knocking them down.
It means you can keep... Yeah, but it also means that you keep them at the table. You know, there's nothing worse when you're playing with kids and stuff and then suddenly one of them has nothing they can do. That is not a great bit of game design for when you're playing with families. But the whole idea of, yeah, you're all playing, you're all collaborating, but one of you's going to be the best...
I'm going to be the winner, chicken dinner.
And you know what? Do you see in my family, right? I will make them all sing a song about the one that won it.
It's like Fight Club with Warren. Before the schools shut down, their asses were like a wad of cookie dough. After 4 weeks of homeschooling with Warren, they're carved from teak.
So you'd be marching around the garden with the box like this. Oh, I'm a winner. And they'd all be coming along behind you, a little flipping coconut, singing a song.
Our daddy is a winner, and we're not whiny bitches. Our daddy is a winner. But I've got to say, you know, this whole homeschooling malarkey has been an interesting journey for me. Andrea barely lets me into the house anymore.
This has been an interesting peek into your life.
Well, Manny, I had another one of those where Andrea called me a wanker moments, right? Manny came out and said, Mom, I think I found something educational. She must have said to him, you know, if you're going to watch something on the Disney Plus, watch something educational. And he comes out and he says, is 13 ways to survive an animal attack considered educational? Now, before Andrea had the chance to speak, I said, yes, son. Yes, it absolutely is. And then she told me I was a tit and put me out of the house again. So, but, you know, I will have my way. I will have my way. I will have my four little preppers all sitting ready. So
when you think about it, you know, the goats are coming back to towns in Wales. It's not going to be long before the wild animals start to prowl the streets again.
This is a scam. If your punishment is to be put out of the house, this is a scam. You're constantly thinking, what will I do next to put out of the house?
I'm telling you, I saw at least a wild dove in our garden. So, you know, you've got to be careful. We don't know where this could go. You know, we are now seeing cats getting this, okay? Tigers have got it, now cats have got it. What if it causes some strange mutation and they all turn into kind of like Tiger King kind of cats? You need to be able to defend yourself. Anyway, I think we're done. Thank you for watching. Come and join us on XLBS on Sunday. We've got some crack because I've got some shit I need to sort out, and I'm gonna show these guys some stuff and get their feedback. Other than that, Ben, always a pleasure. It really is a pleasure, man. We're probably not going to bring the other guy back, if I'm being honest.
Do your impression, Ben. Do your impression.
Oh, my God, this is so cool.
Jerry, always lovely to have the Mad Monk himself on the show. And Lloydy, thank you for sickening me every time with that.
Let me just step out of the way.
Oh, what a get. Guys, have a great week of gaming.
Go ahead and check out our other content on screen now. And while you're at it, why not hit subscribe? And remember to ding our dong. Go on, you know you want to click it. Go on.